We'll now begin with the daily routine, beginning with presenting and reading of petitions. The Honourable Member for Hants East.
Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to table petition, the operating of clause of which reads, we, the undersigned, as concerned residents or property owners of Mount Uniac, request that the Minister of Environment halt the current timetable of April 30th, mid-May, in the decision-making process until concerns have been dealt with, and instruct Mr. Byrne's office to notify Ms. Miller's offices of his halt, and that, number two, the Minister's offices look into and ensure that due diligence is being done pertaining to these concerns not satisfactorily dealt with or explained to date. Number three, we ask the Minister to instruct his department that no decision be granted on this quarry application until the public community of Mount Uniac have had these above concerns satisfactorily explained. And finally, number four, request and suggest that the best way to convey these answers and explanations to all concerned parties is via public forum, of which public notice will be given with ample notification. So this petition contains 52 signatures, and I have affixed my own. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Good job.
The petition is tabled. Presenting reports of committees. The Honourable Member for Dartmouth East.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. As Vice Chair of the Committee on Law Amendments, I am directed to report the committee has met and considered the following bills. Bill number 97, an Act to Protect Healthcare Information to Promote Quality Improvement, and Bill number 98, an Act Respecting Chartered Professional Accountants of Nova Scotia. And the committee recommends these bills to the favourable consideration of the House without amendment.
Order that these bills be referred to the Committee of the Whole House on Bills. Tabling reports, regulations, and other papers. Statements by ministers. Government notices of motion. Introduction of bills. The Honourable Minister of Finance.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I beg leave to introduce an act entitled An Act Respecting Certain Financial Measures.
The Honourable Minister of Finance begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act Respecting Certain Financial Measures.
Bill number 108, entitled An Act Respecting Certain Financial Measures.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. The Honourable Minister of Business, Municipal Affairs and Service, Nova Scotia.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I beg leave to introduce a bill titled An Act to Establish Tourism Nova Scotia.
The Honourable Minister of Business begs leave to introduce a bill entitled An Act to Establish Tourism Nova Scotia.
Bill number 109, entitled An Act to Establish Tourism Nova Scotia.
Ordered that the bill be read a second time on a future day. We'll now move on to notices of motion. Statements by members. The Honourable Member for Halifax, Chibucto.
Mr. Speaker, as a first-generation Canadian of Dutch heritage, I rise today in the House proudly wearing orange. This is one of the few days a year where I wear this colour, as today is Koningendag, also known as the King's Day. This is a day of celebration in Holland for the monarchy. The celebration started in 1890 after Princess Wilhelmina became queen after her death of her father. From 1890 until 2 years ago, it has been known as the Queen's Day. But following the abdication of Queen Beatrix, her son, the current monarch, William Alexander, became the first king to serve since the observance of this holiday. The celebration in Holland is marked by the streets of parade, musical performance, and other great acts of entertainment. William Alexander travels throughout Holland to take place in these various celebrations. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Argyle-Barrington.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. In the past few weeks in the sitting, I've had the occasion to reflect on the words of a man we pay homage to often in this legislature. And quote, when I sit down in the solitude of the labors of my profession, the only questions I ask myself are what is right, what is just, and what is for the public good. Many recognize these words as Mr. Joseph Howe, a stalwart champion of the rights and freedoms of the press. The government seems intent upon setting House hours to rush flawed legislation through, including scheduling back-to-back bill briefings that conflict with law amendments. This disorganized scheduling has limited media's ability to do their jobs properly. It's unfortunate that due to this incompetence of this government, one of the most important freedoms is being undermined, and that is of informing the public on the progress of this people's House. We should therefore be guided by Mr. Howe's mantra and ask ourselves daily what is right, what is just, and what is for the public good.
The Honourable Member for Halifax Needham.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, the NDP caucus voted no to the McNeill government's budget. The targets are young people and puts jobs at risk. The government slashed and subsequently capped the film tax credit without any plan to grow the industry and create new jobs. The government's elimination of jobs across the province, including the closure of visitor information centres and cuts to provincial park staff. And the government is opening the door to rapid tuition increases by lifting the tuition cap. The McNeill government is putting health care at risk, making life less affordable for students, and has no plan to create jobs and grow the economy. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Chester St. Margaret's.
Mr. Speaker, last week all members of the opposition voted against the McNeill government's budget. We voted against cutting funding to the AIDS Coalition of Cape Breton and against the elimination of the Film and Creative Industries Nova Scotia. We voted against the McNeill government's disastrous cuts to eating disorder programming in Nova Scotia and against the free-for-all tuition increases next year. We voted against freezing income assistance rates for the second year in a row and against the abundance of cuts affecting services in rural Nova Scotia. Unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, the McNeill government used their majority government to pass the budget with every single one of their MLAs voting in favour of these cuts. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Hants East.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I just want to have a very short message today. Today is my husband's birthday. And it made me reflect on all of us standing here in this house. And also, as we all stand here, none of us stand alone. We all have people back home that are here with us in spirit. They support us. They listen to our rants when we come home and listen to our discussions and all too many political conversations that they want no part of. So today I want to thank my husband for the support that he has been and thank all of our families because not one of us would be here without the support that we have at home. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Argyle-Barrington.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to congratulate Karen Gorham on being honoured the 41st Annual Provincial Volunteer Awards on April 7th. The town of Clarks Harbour nominated Ms. Gorham as Provincial Volunteer of the Year for her outstanding dedication to her community. For over 10 years, Karen's been a treasurer of the Oakville Cemetery Club. She fundraises for Port Clyde area churches and the local fire department. She's a devoted member of the Rosalind Nickerson Care Fund and the New Horizons Seniors Club. Karen's an active member of her church and has been a member of the Rebecca Lodge for over 20 years. She volunteers much of her time to deliver Meals on Wheels throughout Cape Sable Island. I do thank Karen for her many years of community service.
The Honourable Member for Sackville-Cobequid.
Mr. Speaker, the NDP voted no to the McNeill government's budget that placed important health care services at risk. The government froze the health care budget and cut frontline patient care. The government cut grants for organizations that provided valuable health care and support services to vulnerable Nova Scotians and their families. And the government provided no new additional long-term care beds and a $3.6 million cut to long-term care facilities budget. The McNeill government needs to focus on what really matters in health care, and that's patient care, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Chester St. Margaret's.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, it's a shame the Premier hasn't learned that you can't just take away workers' rights. Bill 1 and Bill 37 showed us a side of the Premier that Nova Scotians hadn't seen before. He told health care workers to take the deal, hinting that if they didn't, he would make sure the next one was much worse for them. Now the Premier has set his sights on our province's well-known post-secondary institutions and the people who work there, not the presidents, of course, Mr. Speaker, who appear to be the only ones the Premier consults on issues related to universities. I'm talking about the people who clear snow on campus so students can get to class, the clerks who make sure our young academics are registered for their courses, and the instructors who work long hours answering questions and marking papers. Why hasn't the Premier learned that workers in this province deserve to be treated with respect?
The Honourable Member for Kings North.
Speaker, I wish to express my congratulations to Jillian Tetlow McPherson of Port Williams, who was named Mount Allison's Female Athlete of the Year. Ms. Tetlow is a third-year biology and environmental science double major. She was an all-Canadian and the ACCAA Badminton Player of the Year and plays both soccer and badminton at Mount Allison. A very deserving honor. Ms. Tetlow's commitment, hard work, and determination is impressive and indeed an inspiration. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Halifax Needham.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, for a Premier who claims to want fewer executives and administrators in the province, he certainly has gotten cozy with university administrators. Not only did the McNeill government pass a budget last week that allows administrators to increase tuition by as much as they would like next year and the following year and the following year, they are now eliminating any sense of security the employees and faculty had through their collective agreements. What message is the Premier sending to students in our province and to workers in our province? Has he not learned anything at all from the unconstitutional debacle of Bills 1, 30, and 37?
The Honourable Member for Sydney River, Myra Lewisburg.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I rise today to congratulate Herbie Sakalakis from Sydney River, who qualified and ran in the Boston Marathon on April the 20th. Herbie is a 34-year-old, and he ran over 1,000 kilometers during his 14 weeks of training. Herbie's married to Denise, and they have two sons, Liam, 6, and Lucas, 4. Herbie works as a CBU as a graphics video production technician. I know Herbie well, and it is truly my pleasure to congratulate him on breaking the 3-hour mark and finishing in the top 10 of the 90 Nova Scotians who ran in the Boston Marathon. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Sackville-Cobequid.
Mr. Speaker, the McNeill government reduction in services at the Eating Disorder Clinic in Halifax needs to be reviewed. A memo obtained from the IWK Health Centre indicates that the Eating Disorders specific care clinic will operate 2 days per week. Previously, it was open 3 days a week. The IWK Eating Disorder team has been cut. A psychologist with over 20 years of experience has retired and has not been replaced. 1 in 6 young women will develop an eating disorder by the age of 20. Eating disorders have the highest mortality rate of any mental illness. The McNeill government needs to focus on patient care. Their budget doesn't, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Sydney River, Myra Lewisburg.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I rise today to recognize Angus McIsaac, who was recently honoured by Mayor Cecil Clark and the Cape Breton Regional Municipality with a Certificate of Bravery and a gold pin for saving 3 women in a house fire in the town of New Waterford 40 years ago. In the early hours of January 21, 1975, when Mr. McIsaac was a New Waterford police officer, he rescued the women from a burning apartment on Plummer Avenue. Mr. McIsaac did not hesitate to put his life at risk to rescue the women without thought for his own safety. It's my privilege to honour Angus McIsaac today in the House of Assembly. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Barring no more member statements, we'll move on to government business. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Mr. Speaker, I move that you do now leave the chair and that the House resolve itself into a committee of the whole on bills.
The House will now recess and while we resolve ourselves into the Committee of the Whole House on Bills.
Committee of the Whole House on Bills will come to order. I recognize the Honourable Government House Leader.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, would you please call Bill number 82, the Change of Name Act and Vital Statistics Act.
Bill number 82, the Change of Name Act and the Vital Statistics Act. The Clerk.
Madam Chair, Bill number 82 has six clauses and was referred back from the Committee on Law Amendments without any amendments.
Okay. Shall Clause 1 carry? Shall remaining clauses carry? Shall the title carry? Shall the bill carry? The bill is carried. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Madam Chair, would you please call Bill number 87, the Audiologists and Speech Language Pathologists Act.
Bill number 87, the Audiologists and Speech Language Pathologists Act. The Clerk.
Madam Chair, the bill contains 71 clauses and was referred back from Law Amendments Committee with several changes. Page 3, paragraph 2ZA, A, add after paragraph VIII the following. IX, collaborate with others, including caregivers, educators, and healthcare providers regarding management, teaching, and rehabilitative strategies for children and adults who have hearing or vestibular disorders or tinnitus. B, renumber subparagraphs IX and X as X and XI, and C, subparagraph X, renumbered as XI, line 3, delete, quote, IX, end quote, and substitute, quote, X, end quote. Then on page 28, subparagraph 69.2.G.I, delete and substitute the following. I, prescribing, dispensing, fitting, and verifying hearing aids for clients other than hearing aids that are surgically implanted under the skin for the purpose of addressing A, sensory hearing loss with or without tinnitus, B, conductive hearing loss with or without tinnitus following clearance by a medical practitioner, or C, retrocochlear hearing loss with or without tinnitus if the client is concurrently managed by an audiologist or an otolaryngologist, and assessing hearing in clients for those purposes. Those are the sum of the amendments, Madam Chair.
Shall Clause 1 carry? Shall the remaining clauses carry with the red amendments? Shall the title carry? Shall the bill carry? The bill is carried. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Madam Chair, would you please call Bill number 88, the Dental Act.
Bill number 88, the Dental Act. The Clerk.
Madam Chair, the Bill 88 contains 9 clauses and was referred back from the Law Amendments Committee without any amendments.
Shall Clause 1 carry? Shall the remaining clauses carry? Shall the title carry? Shall the bill carry? The bill is carried. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Madam Chair, would you please call Bill number 90, the Tobacco Access Act.
Bill number 90, the Tobacco Access Act. The Clerk.
Madam Chair, Bill 90 contains 5 clauses and was referred back from Law Amendments Committee without amendments.
Shall Clause 1 carry? Shall the remaining clauses carry? Shall the title carry? Shall the bill carry? The bill is carried. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Madam Chair, I move that the committee do now rise and report progress to the House.
The motion is carried. The committee will now rise and report its business to the House.
Order, please. Chair of the committee will report.
That the committee of the whole has met and considered the following bills, bills 82, 88, and 90 without amendments, and bill 87, which was reported with certain amendments by the committee on law amendments to the committee of the whole without further amendments, and the chairman has been instructed to recommend these bills to the favorable consideration of the House.
The Honourable Government House Leader.
Mr. Speaker, would you please call under government business private and local bills for second reading?
We'll now call private and local bills for second reading.
Speaker, would you please call Bill number 104, the Milford Haven Fire Protection Commissioners Act.
We'll now call Bill number 104. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Speaker, on behalf of my honourable colleague from Guysborough Eastern Shore Tracadie, I now move that Bill 104 be read a second time.
Question? Motion is for second reading of Bill number 104, the Milford Haven Fire Protection Commissioners Act. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried.
Bill number 104, entitled An Act to Amalgamate the Fire Protection Commissioners of the Fire Department of the Fire District of Guysborough and the Fire Protection Commissioners for the Fire District of Manchester Boylston.
Ordered that this bill be referred to the Committee on Private and Local Bills. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Speaker, would you please call Bill number 106, the Colchester Regional Development Agency, an act to wind up.
We'll now call Bill number 106, the Colchester Regional Development Agency, an act to wind up. The Honourable Member for Colchester North.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and for the information of the members here, Bill 106, the wind-up of the Colchester Regional Development Agency, is necessary in order for funds which are being held by that agency to be released to the appropriate municipalities, that being the Town of Stewiacke, Town of Truro, County of Colchester. And with the dissolution of the RDAs, this money is being held there by the agency and cannot be accessed, so this bill is necessary in order to allow that to happen. So I would move that Bill 106 be read for a second time.
Motion is for second reading of Bill number 106, the Colchester Regional Development Agency, an act to wind up. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried.
Bill number 106, entitled An Act to Wind Up the Colchester Regional Development Agency.
Ordered that this bill be referred to the Committee on Private and Local Bills. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Speaker, would you please call public bills for second reading?
Now call public bills for second reading.
Speaker, would you please call Bill number 101, the Private Career Colleges Regulation Act.
We'll now call Bill number 101, the Private Career Colleges Regulation Act. The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that Bill 101, an act to amend Chapter 23 of the Acts of 1998, the Private Career Colleges Regulation Act, be now read a second time. Mr. Speaker, I'm sure everyone in this House would agree that all forms of post-secondary education are important in making sure young people get the skills and training they need for good jobs. Mr. Speaker, we're well known for our top-notch post-secondary institutions in Nova Scotia, including 10 universities, 13 Nova Scotia community college campuses, and more than 45 private career colleges. Private career colleges provide students with a wide variety of training options that link them to good jobs right here at home. Mr. Speaker, Nova Scotia's private career colleges offer 250 programs to more than 4,000 students each year, training them for careers for a variety of careers, including information technologists, plumbers, cosmetologists, firefighters, continuing care assistants, and carpenters. We value these institutions and the contributions they make to the economy. That's why it's important to ensure our legislation is current and the programs they offer meet job market demands. Mr. Speaker, changes to the Private Career Colleges Regulation Act will improve program quality, hold colleges more accountable, and speed up administrative processes. As part of the amendments, we'll remove the annual registration requirement, and that's to reduce unnecessary paperwork. We'll also streamline the approval of programs already sanctioned by a regulatory or professional body. Mr. Speaker, we'll be able to exempt certain programs like those with very low fees or short completion times. As Minister, I'll have the authority to exempt groups of occupations like fitness instructors. Mr. Speaker, these amendments will require regular program approvals every 5 years. Performance standards will also be phased in to ensure colleges are accountable to students for their investment, which could include considerations like employment rates after graduation. Mr. Speaker, for those changes to have teeth, they'll require enforcement. These amendments include tools like compliance orders and administrative sanctions to deal with minor violations of the Act. Mr. Speaker, a few days ago I tabled legislation that requires more accountability and cost control at Nova Scotia's universities. Private career colleges should be held accountable too. Mr. Speaker, the Department plans to change the regulations to require colleges to provide audited financial statements. Regulation changes will also further define performance standards and exemptions for certain programs and groups of occupations. We'll consult with college administrators and operators before those steps are taken. Mr. Speaker, these changes are not expected to take effect until this time next year. This will give institutions time to understand the new requirements and make necessary adjustments. Mr. Speaker, these amendments are about making sure students are getting a quality education that will help them land good jobs after graduation. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Northside Westmount.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and it's a pleasure to rise to speak to Bill 101, the Private Career Colleges Regulation Act. There are about 45 private career colleges in the province of Nova Scotia that, as the Minister said, offers 250 programs to over 4,000 students. Mr. Speaker, they offer an important service to Nova Scotians, providing courses on skills needed to move our economy forward. This is a step in the right direction as it reduces the burden of these institutions to fill out unnecessary paperwork that increases administration costs that end up being passed on to our students. Mr. Speaker, hopefully this will identify some of the new courses that are necessary or some of the areas where we can add to more, producing more students and more people in the workplace where their programs are necessary. It will also phase in performance standards to ensure that colleges are accountable to students for their investments. Oversight and accountability in these programs is important. The spirit of the bill seems to recognize this. We understand that in the creation of the bill, private colleges throughout the province were consulted, and they were to provide feedback where they were facing difficulties. We hope that this discussion will continue to best determine how government can enable these institutions to best assist and teach students in this province. We expect the department will work with these private institutions to best promote programs that will lead to real employment and real employment opportunities for graduates. Overall, the legislation reduces red tape while increasing accountability to students. And this is the spirit that the PC caucus supports. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable House Leader for the New Democratic Party.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I'm glad to rise just for a few moments to talk on Bill 101. Definitely in our province, we have a number of private colleges that educate thousands of Nova Scotia students, and I think it's important as we move on and try to modernize our legislation that we do it in a manner that it has a positive effect to the courses and to the education that our young people especially have in front of them. But we have to remind ourselves I don't want to say older students, but more mature students use these private colleges to upgrade their education. And I hope that the government recognizes, and I understand the need to ensure that the courses provided are geared towards the marketplace and the employment opportunity here in our province, but try to remind ourselves that it's not just in our own province. There's opportunities globally, and I think as we move forward, I think consultation is the key. Ensuring that there's an open dialogue between these private colleges, between the students that are looking for educational options in our province, that we continue and the government continue to have that opportunity there. So we look forward to this piece of legislation going through over to law amendments, where we may hear from those who are directly affected by this change in legislation, and we look forward to that process, Mr. Speaker.
If I'm to recognize the Honourable Minister of Labour, it will be to close second reading on Bill number 101, the Private Career Colleges Regulation Act. The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Mr. Speaker, I move we close debate on Bill 101.
Motion is to close second reading of Bill 101, the Private Career Colleges Regulation Act. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried.
Bill number 101, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 23 of the Acts of 1998, the Private Career Colleges Regulation Act.
Ordered that the bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Speaker, would you please now call Bill 105, the Education Act.
We'll now call Bill number 105, the Education Act. The Honourable Minister of Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I rise today to speak to Bill 105, an act to amend Chapter 1 of the Acts of 1995-96, the Education Act. Mr. Speaker, on Friday, I tabled amendments to the Education Act that made a clear path for a new provincial code of conduct. The bill allows for action items in the Nova Scotia Action Plan for Education, and it follows what we heard from Nova Scotians. It will provide a plan that will shape the future of education in the province for the next 5 years. We developed the comprehensive plan based on the feedback from those Nova Scotians, and we are committed to renew, refocus, and rebuild the education system. Currently, each school board, and in many cases individual schools, create their own code of conduct. This has led to inconsistencies of implementation across the province. And through the feedback from the minister's panel, we heard Nova Scotians tell us bullying remains an issue inside and outside of schools. Teachers need more support to address classroom behaviours that are disruptive to the learning and sometimes unsafe. Consequences are not always appropriate for the severity of the incidents, such as violence towards teachers and/or other students and/or other adults in the building. And the learning climate depends on staff and is very different from one school to the next. To address these concerns, the action plan dedicated Pillar 3 to looking at an inclusive school environment, and it identified the need for a ministerial policy on the code of conduct. That code of conduct will provide clear and concise standards for behavior, programs of prevention and intervention to support and promote positive student behavior, standards of acceptable and unacceptable behaviors in our Nova Scotia schools, the roles and responsibilities of our partners in education, identify consequences for unacceptable behavior, procedures for reporting, recording, and tracking incidents of unacceptable behavior, and the requirements for monitoring incidents of unacceptable behavior both at the school board level and at the provincial level. The new school code of conduct will apply to all schools in all school boards effective September 2015, and it will help strengthen a school's ability to respond effectively to those behaviors, including bullying, cyberbullying, violence, and all forms of harassment. In order to move forward, changes were required in the Education Act to align with the new code, and the proposed changes in the Act will give more clearly defined standards for behavior, replace regional and school code of conduct with one provincial code, increase the time that a principal may suspend a student without board approval from 5 to 10 days. Schools and school boards will provide support for student learning in the event of an out-of-school suspension. In the bill briefing on Friday, some questions were raised about the increased days for suspensions by principals. We looked across the country and we found that there is a wide range from 5 days to 30 days, and that Nova Scotia is still on the lower end of that scale. This does not mean that principals will use this as their first option. The code outlines a number of options for addressing student behavior, and they are progressive in nature. This is so that as we are addressing the root cause of behavior and we are not looking only to be punitive, we need to focus, Mr. Speaker, on prevention and intervention. However, the 10 days does give principals and teachers another way to help address violence, bullying, and the issues that comprise the safety of the school interfacing with teaching and learning. Once the amendments to the education are passed, Mr. Speaker, the department will move forward with providing professional development to principals and school members, and the department is also developing a webinar for teachers. Schools will inform parents of the changes by sending a copy of the Code of Conduct home with every student. In developing the new code, we held focus groups with teachers, school boards, superintendents, school board chairs, and parents through their school advisory councils. I want to acknowledge their contribution and feedback and thank them for their dedication and time. I also want to thank Nova Scotians who took the time to highlight this important issue through the education consultations. And Mr. Speaker, as I conclude, I move that this bill be read a second time at a future date.
The Honourable Member for Pictou Centre.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to have the opportunity to speak on the Act to amend Chapter 1 of the Acts 95-96, the Education Act. And Mr. Speaker, I think I should start off by saying this is a welcome information with regard to the school code of conduct in our schools across the province. Inappropriate behavior consumes just too much instructional time, Mr. Speaker, in our schools, and I think this is definitely a step in the right direction to curb a lot of this inappropriate behavior. And often, of course, this inappropriate behavior leads to power struggles and the inconsistency with regard to instructional time that is wasted throughout the school day. Mr. Speaker, occasionally minor disruptions quietly escalate into what we would call classroom battles, a little power control between students or perhaps between instructors and students. So this can erode relationships and respect that we certainly want to see in the school environment. Inappropriate behavior has been a problem for schools for far too long, and this code of conduct certainly is a step in the right direction. One of the first things we need to understand is why and how students misbehave, Mr. Speaker. They are highly predictable categories that help us understand why some schools have students that misbehave. They include the need for attention, power, control, competence, and the need for belonging. Mr. Speaker, it's critical that teachers get to know their students, understand their students, and the impact of their home life. And this is all part of the school code of conduct. School code of conduct, of course, are the guidelines that they have to help them manipulate through the days and the weeks in the school system. All humans want to feel like they have some influence and control in their lives, and it's no different with students. One of the main reasons why students misbehave in school, in my opinion, is because they feel they cannot succeed in school. So if they feel they cannot succeed in school, Mr. Speaker, they start misbehaving. And I'd like to revert to another area that I think will play an important part in the school of conduct, Mr. Speaker, because many students over the last number of years misbehaved because they felt like they couldn't achieve. I think with the appropriate measures the minister has been involved in with regard to extra attention given to an intervention into early childhood development, into the early grades, with P to 3, with the math and literacy and grades after that, I think eventually a lot of these students that we have experienced over the years misbehaving because they had great difficulty achieving in those areas. So with that extra attention and the extra funding and so on into these areas, I think eventually that will help also curb that particular reason for students misbehaving, because for far too long we have seen so many that have reached the junior and senior high levels and not able to achieve because they had missed so many concepts up through the years. The Mr. Speaker, some students of course need to be connected. There's all kinds of reasons why they misbehave. In this particular code of conduct, there's numerous prevention strategies that will be available. I am sure that professional development days will be available also for teachers and administrators to bring themselves up to speed with regard to the new code of conduct. And as the minister mentioned, it'll be very important for everyone to be on board on the same page, parents, students,
support staff, administrators, and teachers. The other thing too, Mr. Speaker, I mean, students today study and work in a world dominated by technology, and that brings to light another area where this code of conduct becomes very, very important. And of course, schools are trying to show students the need to learn to use it safely and effectively, ethically, and respectfully, the technology that's used in our schools. So this legislation, Mr. Speaker, is positive. It's good legislation. I am very happy to see it. It's something that has been needed for a long time, and because we need some consistency. For too long, schools had interpretations of conduct different from other schools. Department, school boards, and schools across the province were not always on the same page. So with one code of conduct province-wide, I think this is going to be very, very positive. So, Mr. Speaker, I'm going to finish with a few words and say that this is legislation that we'll be supporting. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Truro, Bible Hill, Millbrook, Salmon River.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And it does give me pleasure to rise today to speak to Bill 105, an act to amend Chapter 1 of the Acts of 1995-96, the Education Act. We support this bill, and I in particular like to see the unacceptable behaviour, including the bullying, which means in subsection 3.1 of Chapter 1, bullying means behavior typically repeated that is intended to cause or should be known to cause, whether directly or indirectly, fear, intimidation, humiliation, exclusion, distress, or other harm to another person's body, feelings, self-esteem, reputation, or property, and includes assisting or encouraging such behavior in any way. I also approve of B, which adds immediately after clause C the following clause, that cyberbullying means any electronic communication through the use of technology, including, without limiting, the generality of the foregoing computers, other electronic devices, social networks, text messaging, instant messaging, websites, and electronic mail, typically repeated or with continuing effect, that is intended to cause or ought to reasonably be expected to cause fear, intimidation, humiliation, distress, or other damage or harm to another person's health, emotional well-being, self-esteem, or reputation, and includes assisting or encouraging such communication in any way. So I think that by simplifying this and including bullying, cyberbullying, discriminatory behavior, illegal activity, insubordination, misuse of network or online resources, physical violence, racist behavior, repeated use of tobacco or electronic cigarettes, sexual assault, sexual harassment, sexual misconduct, significant disruption to school operations, and the use or possession of alcohol, drug-related paraphernalia, illegal drugs, weapons, vandalism, or verbal abuse actually makes a lot of sense to me. And as the former colleague mentioned, a lot of kids today do want to try and fit in, they want to belong, and sometimes they will act out in ways that are harmful to themselves or others purely because they want to try and belong and or stand out or get some kind of attention. But I think that teachers are at their wits' end trying to control some of this bad behavior, and we need to be able to make it a little easier for them to be able to bring the hammer of the law down within the system. But I also want to flag as well that I think it's so important that our teachers again be consulted with all of these different changes to any kind of education acts. Because how can education reform really be truly valid if teacher opinions and teacher research not be included? So the Nova Scotia Teachers Union and the Canadian Teachers Federation have been researching educational issues and collecting data on various educational topics for years using a variety of means, Mr. Speaker. So we would really like to see the department wanting to collaborate with these professionals who are working with students on a daily basis and who have seen the effects of various government policies on our students on a daily basis and on our classrooms over the years.
So if educational reform is not just a smoke and mirror attempt to make education more viable for students and teachers, then I think the government really needs to include active teachers and their voices in any decisions that they make. Teachers need to be included on education committees. I think that their voices and experience and professionalism are valid, and it's not valid to rely just only on retired teachers or outsiders to give their viewpoints. Even student opinion will have a different vantage point to the teacher viewpoint, and parent viewpoints will be different from a teacher's. So the views of teachers on forming new codes of conduct policy and reforming the AESOP, streamlining curriculum outcomes and updating forms on the Tianet like IPPs, adaptations, behavior plans, all of this work needs to include the teachers' voices and the experience of the Nova Scotia Teachers Union. The Department of Education should want to build teacher morale and act as a bridge between teachers and the public, and not demoralize teachers by talking about just fixing the system that they've been trying to glue together for years because of slash and cut policies over the years. And we need to see education and teachers as a real asset to our province, because it's the compassion and the creativity and the caring of teachers who will actually help our youth grow into citizens, who will make our province grow and prosper. And with that, Mr. Speaker, I take my place.
The Honourable Member for Pictou East.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It's a pleasure to rise this afternoon and say a few words on this important bill. This is an issue for me. I've had a relationship with a situation across the province where it's high school kids, pretty strong disagreements between them. And it got to the point where one child got a restraining order against the other child, but they both stayed in the same school. So the net impact of that was the student who was bullied and was bullied in the eyes of the courts, which issued a restraining order, stopped going to school. Just couldn't go to school. Couldn't face the other person, and it's just caused a lot of emotional damage for both families and for all the students involved. So. I only raise that example because I wonder in the code of conduct as it's developed if there could be a mechanism where the schools, and it wouldn't always be possible in some rural communities, there might not be two schools, but in situations where there are schools within a certain geographic area, maybe in a case like that the student could be moved to another school to respect the restraining order and to give everyone the peace of mind. So that's something that I'll be looking to see if that can be incorporated into the code of conduct in situations where it gives the board or the principal or somebody the power to acknowledge what the courts have decided. I wondered, and I don't know the answer to this, but I was interested in the fact that the new code of conduct would allow principals to suspend a student for a maximum of 10 days instead of the 5 from before. And, you know, on the face of it, that sounds like a really good thing, and I'm sure that's going to be necessary in certain student behavioral situations, be necessary for the benefit of everyone. But it was raised to me in discussion of the question was asked, would that be used? And I was thinking back when I was hearing that person ask those questions to some interactions I've had with friends that are police officers over the years, they would hear about incidents at different schools and they'd go to check it out and say, well, no, there was no incident, or it was dealt with already or something like that. So I was thinking in the context of does it suit the administration, does it help the administration in any way, and I don't know the answer, to have fewer suspensions, fewer disciplinary actions on record? Does it give the perception that the school runs smoothly? So, and I don't know the answer, Mr. Speaker, but I did want to raise that as a question and as a consideration for the Department of how schools are evaluated, how schools are assessed. In that assessment process, is there kind of demerits or merits for fewer or more disciplinary actions? So I do echo my my colleague from PICTO Center's support of the bill. I think the bill is a good thing, but there are other considerations that I think might be useful in this case. And I was looking at the recording and tracking of incidents of unacceptable behavior. Like, where does that go, and how does that get used by the department or by the board or whatever the case may be? So, so two things to think about. Both coming down, I guess, on the side of more discipline in the case of keeping students separated that the courts have thought should be, and the other one in the case of making sure that principals are free to use the, in this case, a suspension of 10 days without kind of a negative reflection back on their school and their situation. And they're just two concerns or questions I felt compelled to stand and raise today. So I leave the minister with those couple comments and with my assurance that I support this bill as it is.
I recognize the Honourable Minister of Education. It will be to close second reading on Bill Number 105, the Education Act. The Honourable Minister of Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the colleagues across the way for their comments. I do want to make sure that people don't see this as bringing down, quote, the hammer of the law. That is exactly the opposite of the intent of this particular legislation. I do appreciate the comments from the member from PICTO East and PICTO Center. I believe that the experience in the classroom or as an administrator, and also the experience that the member from PICTO East has had with respect to students who have had some difference of opinion and may not be able to, it may not be beneficial for them both to be in the same building, are certainly good issues to raise. The intent of having the extension from 5 to 10 days is to allow those people who know the students best, that being the teachers, the support staff, and the principal, to try to resolve the issues and provide the appropriate suspension if necessary, but definitely the appropriate supports within the school environment, rather than take it to a committee of an elected board that perhaps don't know the circumstances as well. So that's the intent of extending it to 10. Again, I would repeat, Mr. Speaker, that this is intended to look at the root cause and address and try to change unacceptable behavior rather than be punitive, but it's also intended to make sure that the classroom environment is positive, safe, conducive to learning, and conducive to teaching. And with those few comments, Mr. Speaker, I thank the members from PICTO East, PICTO Center, and I do want to close the debate on second reading of Bill 105.
Motion is to close debate on second reading of Bill Number 105, the Education Act. Would all those in favor of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion carried.
Bill Number 105, entitled An Act to Amend Chapter 1 of the Acts of 1995-96, the Education Act.
Order that this bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. The Honourable Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, please call Bill Number 103, the Municipal Government Act.
We'll now call Bill Number 103, the Municipal Government Act. The Honourable Minister of Municipal Affairs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I move second reading of Bill 103, the Municipal Government Act. Mr. Speaker, the legislation before the legislature repeals some provisions of the municipal government which authorize electors to apply to the Nova Scotia Utility and Review Board for incorporation as a town. It also repeals some provisions of the Act which authorize the UARB to order the continuation of a dissolved town as a village. In other words, it prevents towns from becoming villages or villages from becoming towns. This change will give us the foundation for strong and viable governance structures and promotes regional thinking. Over the past year, Mr. Speaker, I've met individually with all municipal councils, and we've had an open and frank dialogue. The topic of structural change has been part of these discussions. I've also been clear in saying that we will not force any municipality to dissolve or amalgamate, but we will support those leaders and those municipal units who initiate structural change that results in efficiencies and long-term viability for their citizens. However, Mr. Speaker, with aging infrastructure, a declining tax base, increased costs for essential services such as fire, police, and transportation, and an aging and declining population, many of our towns are struggling and facing financial challenges. The One Nova Scotia report, the town's task force, and the provincial municipal fiscal review all highlight the need for reform of municipal government and regional service structures to achieve efficiencies. Today's amendments will help ensure a positive future and long-term viability for municipalities in Nova Scotia. Mr. Speaker, we need to look beyond our backyards, recognize current trends and realities for the sustainability of our municipalities. This change does not dissolve any existing towns or villages. It will help provide municipalities with more efficiencies and more stability, as well as promote regional cooperation. With that, Mr. Speaker, I look forward to the comments of my colleagues.
The Honourable Member for Pictou West.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for his comments. I'm honoured to stand in my place today to speak to Bill 103. We all know that strong, viable municipal units are something that we all want, and as well as we are all aware that the recent release of the Financial Condition Index shows us that many municipal units are struggling, and we're all concerned about the long-term viability of some of these municipalities and feel that possibly they are in jeopardy. We've all had the opportunity to read the Ivany report and learn that it recommended a municipal reform process. In fact, Goal 18 of the Ivany report requires that the province take the opportunity to review the municipal government structures that are in place. And this is something that I agree with, and I think that most people would agree with and see the necessity in having this done soon, actually. In my view, I think surrounding municipalities, a lot of problems and misunderstandings arise because they don't see government, all of us here, actually having a plan forward for them. And they often think that they're solo and there's no one really to support them in government going forward. And so, you know, we know that Nova Scotia has, I believe, 24 villages, and I don't believe they were consulted on the town task force. I know that in March the minister sent out a press release saying that he would not force amalgamation or dissolution on villages. He said as well the department would work with municipalities and villages on sustainable solutions and not force them to dissolve or amalgamate. And I can only speak for myself. I don't know about all other municipalities in Nova Scotia, but I do know the minister has closely worked with the municipality of Pictou County, and they're grateful for his time and conversations. You know, I think going forward, it could possibly be a good piece of legislation. If the Ivany goals were enshrined, however, in legislation, we would all know when the plan would be complete, and we would know what the government's end goal is for municipalities. I think that's a little bit unclear right now, but despite bills from both, I believe, I know from our party as well as the ND party, the government has chosen not to take the important step to see those bills come to fruition. But I do recognize, I think it's a good opportunity to recognize that there is some concerns from you know, the area of New Minas and Chester with regards to this, and I can't speak for them. I'm not in that area, nor did I have an opportunity to speak really
with anyone from that area. I know that New Mind has spent, you know, a fair amount of money on studying and evaluating, and I think back in the 1990s, Chester spent actually over $100,000 in studying the process of becoming a town. So I just hope that the minister will take an opportunity, perhaps he already has, to reach out to New Minas as well as Chester. And myself, Mr. Speaker, and the caucus support this bill going forward to the Standing Committee on Law Amendments, and we certainly are eager and anxious to hear from presenters. There's no doubt that we all want a very strong, viable municipal units within our province, and I'm sure that the minister intends to see this happen. Thank you very much.
The Honourable Member for Chester St. Margaret's.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And this subject is dear to my heart, coming from Chester and living in Chester Village all my life. And I have to respectfully disagree with the minister and the government in terms of the lack of consultation with the residents of Chester and New Minas, and I believe through the village commissions throughout the province. And this piece of legislation, what I really believe comes down to, which I find very disturbing, is the rights, and I'll say that again, the rights of residents to choose in terms of whether they want to live in a village or town. And that's what I find so disturbing about this legislation, because when people have the right to voice their opinions and when people have the right to come together and make a decision of where they want to live and what type of residence they want to live in, whether it's a town or village, they get the right to make that choice, and they should have that very, very that right to do that. And that's what we call a democracy. And that's what's bothering me here, is the fact that, you know, if you look at governments in the world that, or a country which has total power over the people that live there, or it's a small group making that decision, that's what they reference as a dictatorship. And a dictatorship is a kind of rule that it doesn't matter what the people want or need. And, you know, I have to contend that I'm very worried that this is the way that we are going here in the province in terms of the number of bills to date that the McNeill government has brought forward that took people's rights away. We're looking at Bill 1 and 37 that took rights away from health care workers. We're now presenting Bill 100 will take the rights away from faculty members and workers in universities, but the ones who have all power will be the presidents of those universities. So this is what I am trying to encourage the minister to consider, is that once again this is going to have an effect on rural Nova Scotia. And I do realize that there has been a lot of financial issues within the municipalities, but what I would suggest is the type of legislation that should actually be brought in is to have an auditing process of the municipalities and look at the municipalities in terms of, are they considering working with neighboring municipalities in terms of sharing resources and sharing cost. There are some municipalities that I am aware of in the province that have taken great effort to do this. The other municipalities had made the decision that no, that they don't want to do that. There's some municipalities, if you look at even their staff complement, the ratio balances even a city. Those are the types of things that the minister should be bringing legislation in, and to look at the fiscal responsibilities of municipalities, and are the dollars being spent appropriately? Where are they being spent? Are they willing to come together with another municipality and work together? And there's some that I I do know of that they do that. Then there's others that don't. And I was involved in a number of years ago when the village of Chester, there were a group of residents who were interested in Chester becoming a town. And I can say that it was an issue that there were good arguments on both sides of whether it should turn from a village to a town. And it was quite a process. And I believe that process is in place within the legislation that we have here today, because the both sides had to prove their points and do a lot of statistical research, which would have been nice if that was done for our film and television industry, and this is what they were required to do if they wanted to become a town. They had to present the evidence and show it on a financial basis of whether or not that village could be sustainable as a town. And I believe that there was about three independent studies done around the village of Chester showing that the tax base would enable the village to actually become a town with the level of tax base that we have there. I do know from the municipality's point of view that there's some concern if that tax base is taken away, that the other communities surrounding the municipality as part of the municipality may have more of a struggle because their tax base is lower. But I think that given legislation that requires that type of studies to be done and be presented to the UARB is exactly exists today. So we do have accountability around that. And I believe that, Mr. Speaker, that it is so important that people feel that they do have the right to make that decision, and that if one-third of the population decides that they want to move forward with changing their village into a town, they're able to go forward with that, but then they have to present all that evidence around it. Or the UARB, who we all, where we respect in their decision-making abilities, will not support that decision. So I'm not standing here and saying whether or not a village should become a town or not. I'm standing here and saying that it should be the right of those people who pay the tax base and live in those communities that have the right to the decision. I do not see where government has the right to come in and tell Nova Scotians whether or not they should be living in a village or town. And when you look at the fact that this very government has been trying to say that the rights in other areas we're seeing have been taken away, but yet the government is saying that they're not going to interfere with business. What they're going to do, Mr. Speaker, is that it's up to business and corporations to become viable and create employment in our province. Yet on the other hand, the hardworking folks in our communities are being told, well, you cannot become a town if you have that desire to become a town. And it's not something that happens in a minute. It's not a quick turnaround. It is a lot of organized work by the Village Commission, and it's a lot of organized work by the community members. And I believe it should be up to the community to make that decision. It's unfair. It takes rights away. And, you know, the other thing that I find that was not truly appropriate was the fact that these villages were quite concerned about a year ago when they kind of heard rumors that the McNeill government was moving in this direction, that based on the report that there was a recommendation to dissolve villages. And in turn, the minister did do a public announcement to tell the villages that no, we're not going to dissolve villages. However, on the flip side, the sentence wasn't completed. And if the sentence was completed and said, well, we're not going to dissolve villages, but we are going to take your rights away to become a town, I think that there would be a different piece of legislation presented here today, because I believe that the minister and government would have heard from many community members throughout all Nova Scotia, in areas where they want to have the rights to make their own decision, would have come forth. And also, oddly enough, there was consultation with the Union of Municipalities, but it fell short of great consultation with the village commissions. And the reason for that is because the government knew that the Union of Nova Scotia Municipalities were more for having some type of legislation that prevented the villages to become a town, because once again they're concerned about their municipal units. And unfortunately there was a lot less of a discussion with the village commissions because of the fact that they knew that if they had heads up on this, that there would be a great deal more of protest in the community and within the media. So that was a surefire way to make sure that we kept the people at bay about this particular decision, because they only found out about it last week when the legislation was brought forward. And, you know, Mr. Speaker, that is not transparency. That is not consultation. And I wish that the government would stop using that language, because the only way that you can use language is if you take actions to your words. You just don't say words. It's all in the actions. And we're seeing a great number of Nova Scotians, whether they're from the healthcare sector or whether they're from the film and television industry, or whether they're university students, whether they're faculty, whether somebody simply lives in a village or somebody lives in a town, their rights are being stripped away by this government. And that's not what we call democracy, or is not what, when you look in the dictionary, it's certainly not defined as that, because people need to have a voice. They need to have the right to be able to pursue what they believe in. And I think it's very unfortunate that the government is bringing forward legislation that takes the rights away. I believe that the legislation in place today could actually be improved in terms of more accountability around becoming a town or a village, if that's the concerns, and that more financial research and data would be provided, not on just the side of the village and how it can sustain itself as a town, but there also needs to be data and independent study on how the rest of the communities within that municipality could be sustainable. And if they both match up and it proves that they both can be sustainable, then what is the problem allowing a village to become a town, if the evidence is there? So I think that the legislation should be protecting the rights of people and not actually taking that right away. And you know, I think that this is another example of taking the right away, and I would encourage the minister that, you know, that this legislation doesn't come forth in the manner that it is, that there is an opportunity or option there, that if the evidence is presented, that then that village or town can pursue whether they want to switch to a village or want to switch to a town. And I think it's all in the fact that if you have the financial independent reports and that the door is open, that the public wants to take it. It's not easy for a community to come together and to have the ability to have that kind of research done. And so if they do that and they support it financially themselves, as what took place before, it did not come out of any budget from the municipality. It was self-supporting. So I think if all those efforts are brought together in a community, which are challenging to do, that then there is a great will to go forward with whatever that change would be. So I think that simply it is about looking at municipalities in a more accountable way of what they're doing That's where some of the issues could be in the viability of our municipalities, not just the fact that a village may want to become a town. I think that that's where we need some work to be done in our province. And just in closing, I would like to say that I am, and I think that many Nova Scotians are concerned by the fact that we need to live in a society that we feel we have the right to pursue what we believe in. And if we have a consensus around that, or we have 50 or 60%, well, then that's what it's all about, being a democracy. Our legislation needs to be written in the format of a democracy, not in a format of a dictatorship that we know best, and that's what we're going to tell the people of Nova Scotia, how to live, where to live, what to do, whether you want to live in a village or town. So I would recommend to the minister that there be more discussion on this legislation, and that there be more work on it and more consultation before it goes through with the village commissions in our province, because unfortunately, Mr. Speaker, that has not been the case. And once again, we're finding that rights are being taken away, not given. Thank you very much.
The Honourable Member for Kings North.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and it is my pleasure to stand to say a few words about Bill 103 also. And the whole issue of municipal governance and what is happening in the province really has been dictated by the economy of rural Nova Scotia being in decline. And we've seen a number of towns that have had significant industries be pulled out of those towns over the time, and they're no longer viable as a town. We've seen some villages that these towns would have had to struggle with this. And this whole issue is going to be a huge issue going forward for this government. But on the other hand, there's villages like New Minas, which are quite prosperous villages. New Minas in particular, I'm not sure if there's any others. And it's been known for about a year that New Minas was considering becoming a town. And in fact, they were into the study that has been mentioned. They've spent about $20,000 on a study, and it's about halfway through and nowhere near complete. And it's hard for, I think, the village of New Minas not to feel that this legislation has been directly sent to them, a message to New Minas: stop, cease and desist. And I think it might be the town of Hansmorp might feel the same way, that although I'm not as certain that they were going towards being a village, it was one option on the table. I do know that. And it might well be that the town of Hansmorp feels that way too. And I have a question for the minister, in that why wasn't this a moratorium, not a cease order? And possibly that would have been a better choice for this moment in time. And the real question is, what is the rest of what is the next page and the next page, which aren't in this bill? What really is the plan for our towns and villages? And so this bill sort of stops everything at this moment, yet at the same time it doesn't answer those questions. And I would suggest that the real question is, what is the process? How are we going to get to some future point in time when we have viable communities, and whatever that ends up looking like? We need to know now what the process is, and I think that that's what's missing in this bill. This bill is just a moment in time, just stops the process at this moment, stops processes that were underway, and I would suggest a moratorium might have been more appropriate than a cease and desist. Certainly the study that's underway in New Minas, there's lots of reasons why that study should be completed. And not simply because they're halfway into that, but for just simply because all of these issues are going to have to be studied to great extent. And we need to know the answers. And our communities need to have viable structures that are efficient and allow rural Nova Scotia to go forward in a prosperous manner, and allow the taxes that come in to be used in efficient manners too. And I think that rather than this bill is sort of presuming an outcome without going through the process. And I think that we need to go through the process. The discussion has to be made. There's been much said about the fact that the municipal, the UNSM and the report on the town's task force report recommended a dissolution of villages, and the minister said, I know in March, that that would not happen. It feels a little bit like teaching a young person to drive a standard. You put it in gear and take a jump ahead and stop, and then we're putting it in gear again and taking another jump ahead, but we're stopping, really. And rather than a process that's sort of going forward and fits and starts, I would suggest to the minister that the process needs to be laid out and explained in an orderly fashion. And maybe in all fairness, maybe that is the next bill. Maybe that's Bill 105 or 106, or maybe the minister has that in mind. And if that is already in mind, I would suggest that the process is the most important thing at the moment. That the villages do not feel left out, that the towns do not feel that left out, the municipalities do not feel left out, but that there is sort of a framework that allows this whole discussion to go forward, and that the right things happen in the right areas for the right reasons, so that we can all continue living in our rural areas and prospering there. And clearly not everything can be controlled in Halifax. We need to have municipal governments. And I would suggest to you that I believe that there will still be some role for villages. I know that my own village of Canning recently solved a parking dispute that I don't know if further up the ladder could have solved that dispute. Clearly, it's also about the dollars and cents, and I don't know where that will all shake out. But we need to, I think that the minister needs to lay out a process that government units, the municipalities, the towns and the villages, can take a look at it and says, yes, that makes sense, that without judging where it'll end up, that the process that we go through makes sense, and that each participant in that process has an opportunity to explain what they want and their hopes and needs and what they see for their community, so that we go forward. And at the end of the day, we need much more efficient municipal government. There's no doubt about that. And government that makes sense for each region. And I think those goals of efficiency need to be put into that process. But I think that just to have a moment in time where, oh, stop, I sympathize with the village of New Minas. They feel this was directed right at them. And I would suggest to you that a moratorium would have been a better choice. But what this bill needed to be about was a more detailed explanation of what the process is and how we are going to work through these decisions in the future. With those words, I take my seat. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Guysborough Eastern Shore, Tracadie.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I'm pleased to rise to speak to this bill. First of all, I have a deep appreciation for the role of civic government in Nova Scotia, as I know that all members of the House do, and there's quite a history here of people who have began their service provincially by first learning the ropes and the pleasures of public service at the civic level. The municipal makeup of Nova Scotia dates back to 1879, when the current template was set out, and we have over 400 elected councillors, mayors, wardens, and commissions, village commissioners in the province. My previous role as warden of the municipality of District of Guysborough, we went through the process that led to the dissolution of the town of Canso, which on dissolution, I believe, was 104 years old, and witnessed the difficulties associated with the decision that led to that circumstance. However, almost 3 years out, I think you would, it's safe to say that the folks of Canso, though apprehensive at the time coming in, have seen some of the benefits of the dissolution. And currently we have the town of Mulgrave, which is one of Nova Scotia's most beautiful seaside communities, which was the second last town incorporated in Nova Scotia, incorporated in 1923. The most recent one was Bedford in 1980.
who are coming to the realization or wrestling with the issue about how do they justify their sustaining their role as a town the present environment with a population of in the vicinity of 900 people. Mr. Speaker, I think for me, municipalities embody the story, the Hans Christian Andersen story of the ugly duckling. And as we all know, that has to do with self-realization. And the ugly duckling had difficulties early on, but when it realized it was really a swan, it opened up a lot of opportunities. And I think that's the lesson for municipalities in Nova Scotia. They have great responsibility. They provide a great service. They have a very wise authority that's been delegated to them in the Municipal Government Act and in the Towns Act associated with the land use planning, which is a fundamental piece of work for municipalities and which takes into consideration the wishes of the local community. And they also do have the somewhat onerous power of expropriation, which of course it hinges on the concept of the public good, and are able to use that authority in the interest of the public good, which sometimes overshadows the individual interest. And I think the public good, the concept of public good, is the underpinning of the very democracy that we are all so fortunate to participate in our province and in our country. I would also say that I'm very pleased that our government's approach, this government's approach in terms of collaboration with the municipalities, the issue of the financial indicators index has been a straightforward laying out of the process and facing the realities, and has helped struggling civic corporations come to grips in a sensible, somewhat clinical way, bereft of some of the emotion that associates itself with some of these decisions that struggling town communities are faced with. The concept of that this bill incorporates, which makes it very clear that the towns are capped at the existence that the levels that they are, and that there won't be any default to villages from a town dissolution, a process that has been evaluated many times, that in particular the dissolution of the town of Canso, probably that decision was held up for 5 years, examining the five difficult years for the citizens of that community, evaluating the merits of dissolving into a village. I see no restriction or harm to towns and villages in this process. I think it makes it very clear what government's position is, and I'm very happy to support that legislation. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
If I'm to recognize the Honourable Minister of Municipal Affairs, it will be to close second reading of Bill number 103, the Municipal Government Act. The Honourable Minister of Municipal Affairs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and I certainly appreciate the comments of my colleagues. I will take a few moments to respond to some of the points, and with some of those points, appreciate the support that colleagues have extended. And with some of those comments, Mr. Speaker, to respectfully disagree with some of the comments that my colleagues have advanced. My colleague from Pictou West spoke specifically, Mr. Speaker, about Recommendation 18 in the Ivany Report. And it does talk about municipal government and regional service structures, inherently villages, and the need to restructure and find a new way forward for governance. And the objective there, Mr. Speaker, is to find efficiencies and eliminate the inefficiencies, and to also find a playing field where we are working together collaboratively to advance the objectives of each of us individually in those communities, but collectively to advance a much stronger model that regional government is able to move forward on in the best interest of those communities. And it doesn't matter which sector we're talking about. I talk to municipalities, and I'm talking now to corporations who are looking to invest in rural Nova Scotia. And they're talking about governance models and the challenges that they face as a business entity in dealing with multiple levels of government. And their objective to reach out and work with those regional government models that facilitate open dialogue, consistent discussions, and the challenges that local governments face when we have competing interests, whether it be at the village or the municipal government level. And that's difficult, Mr. Speaker, because it's hard to give up what we believe is in the best interests of our communities. But, Mr. Speaker, recently we've experienced three various dissolutions in the towns of Spring Hill, Bridgetown, and the town of Hansport, who are presently waiting for a decision from the UARB. And, Mr. Speaker, in each of those examples, it was strong leadership, it was the need to address the challenges that they're facing, some more immediate than others, and their ability to respond in a way that best reflects the interests of the larger community. And the relationships in Spring Hill and Cumberland County, and the relationship in Bridgetown and Annapolis County, and the relationship in Hansport and West Hants are examples of local government working together and not competing with one another, but working together to find a better outcome for their community. When my colleague from Pictou West referenced recommendation number 18, that is what the One Nova Scotia report had envisioned. And I want to thank my colleague for her comments in support of this particular bill. We believe it is a good piece of legislation. Mr. Speaker, I want to jump ahead to the comments of my colleague from Kings North. Certainly we recognize the circumstances in the Numinus village and the initiatives that they've undertaken. Mr. Speaker, I would suggest to the members of this House, and to all Nova Scotians for that matter, that there's no perfect time for government to make tough decisions. We pursue and advance a level of dialogue that we hope is engaging, and we hope that it is considering the best interests from their point of view, but also from government's point of view. And although the challenges in Numinus are no different than any other community, a strong village that has a vision and a sustainable future, but Mr. Speaker, not every village is in the same set of circumstances. And what we've found since the provincial fiscal Provincial Municipal Fiscal Review was released, tremendous disagreement, Mr. Speaker, in the content of that report within our municipal membership, but also amongst our village representatives. So I acknowledge the comments of my colleague from Kings North. We will work with the village of Numinus going forward. I strongly encourage the village of Numinus to finish their review. It would be valuable to us as feedback and input into the discussions around future governance models. So I would encourage my colleague to reach out to the chair of the Numinus Village Commission. We would value the feedback and the outcomes of the report that they've undertaken. But Mr. Speaker, I said earlier, there's no perfect time to make tough decisions. There's a tremendous amount of discussion resulting from the Provincial Municipal Fiscal Review around models of government. And the opinions are varied. What we don't want, Mr. Speaker, is for that continued uncertainty to go forward. So it is important with government that we make clear decisions. And although not everyone will agree, it is important to provide some stability to that environment. And in these circumstances, Mr. Speaker, we listened to the Nova Scotia Village Commission, Village Association. I met with their executive, and their president is the chair of the Chester Village Commission. And we heard, Mr. Speaker, the concerns that they had. And it was from that discussion and other inquiries that we were able to take a clear position on one of the recommendations in the Provincial Municipal Fiscal Review that recommended villages be eliminated. And our position was that we sustain villages as they are. And Mr. Speaker, I was pleased with the feedback from the Village Association and other villages around the province specific to that decision. Mr. Speaker, I do want to speak to the comments of my colleague from Chester St. Margaret's. And I think it's critically important that that we talk about the process, as my colleague from King's North had referenced. My colleague from Chester St. Margaret spoke about a lack of consultation with municipalities and villages. And she spoke about the right to live in a village or town as people choose, and that they should have that democratic right to make that decision. Well, Mr. Speaker, I want to remind my colleague from Chester St. Margaret's that it was her government in November of 2010 that signed off and supported the Provincial Fiscal Municipal Review in the absence of village participation. It was not this government, Mr. Speaker. I want this House and I want Nova Scotians to understand that. So the important piece going forward, Mr. Speaker, from our perspective as government, we committed with the decisions that the previous government made to uphold those where we could. And when the Provincial Municipal Fiscal Review was brought to my attention, at the stage it was, about 85% complete, it would be inappropriate for me as the minister to bring that process to a conclusion only to restart the process again. I acknowledged at that time that the village voice was absent. But Mr. Speaker, I want to remind this House, it was the previous government in November of 2010 who implemented that review and took that course and directed the UNSM to follow that course in the absence of villages. So for my colleague from Chester St. Margaret's to stand in this House today and lead the citizens of Chester Village to believe that this is a liberal issue, a liberal problem, is not the case, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, my colleague also spoke about the auditing process of municipalities. Mr. Speaker, my colleague spoke about the auditing process of municipalities. And one of the things we've done, Mr. Speaker, over the past 18 months, with the work of cooperation and the work of municipalities and staff within municipal affairs, is we embarked upon an auditing process, if you wish to call it that, the Financial Condition Index, which has become a very valuable tool designed by, in part with provincial government staff, designed by municipalities to provide them a template so that they themselves can review and analyze the circumstances of their individual municipality to support or not support their sustainability. And what that does, Mr. Speaker, is it allows not only the elected officials, but it allows the residents to review and examine the circumstances of that community. And Mr. Speaker, the FCI, the Financial Condition Index, was used in each of Spring Hill, Bridgetown, and Hansport. And Mr. Speaker, when we embarked on that process in those communities, there was a tremendous amount of emotion expressed in each of the three communities. And we've just experienced that, Mr. Speaker, in Mulgrave. The first public meeting held last Thursday night identified the concerns of residents. They were speaking with emotion and the passion and the love they have for their community. And I acknowledge and I want to extend my appreciation for their willingness to come out and participate in that forum, as they did in each of the three other communities, Spring Hill, Bridgetown, and Hansport. Mr. Speaker, the FCI, when presented, based on information that the municipalities feed into the document, to the template, is an accurate assessment and one tool that municipalities are able to utilize in making decisions and building business plans for their future. And Mr. Speaker, that tool has been used in each of those communities to advantage. Mr. Speaker, when I met with the Nova Scotia Village Association executive, they spoke about an audit document, and they spoke about the need to assess villages in a similar manner. And Mr. Speaker, we've committed in the Department of Municipal Affairs to create an equal model that would serve the same purpose in villages. Although the criteria and numbers of components would be smaller, it would serve the same purpose, Mr. Speaker, and allow villages to make similar informed decisions on their future and what they believe that would look like. So, Mr. Speaker, to my colleague's point from King's North, we have implemented an audit process that will provide valuable support to the villages. But, Mr. Speaker, I really want to take a moment before I conclude to speak to a couple of points that my colleague from Chester St. Margaret's raised. And she talked about the need for businesses and corporations to be viable, and she paralleled that with villages' ability to become a town. And Mr. Speaker, I simply want to take my colleague back to Recommendation 18 in the One Nova Scotia report and how that recommendation identifies both the municipal government structure and the regional service structure and the need to find a new governance model, the responsibility of government to find another model that provides a strong, viable future for those communities within a particular region. So it doesn't matter if it's Chester St. Margaret's or if it's Lunenburg or Lunenburg West or Queen Shelburne, we have to start to look beyond our existing borders with a regional lens so that we can compete with other regions in our country and literally, Mr. Speaker, globally. Mr. Speaker, I don't have to tell anyone in this House the strength of technology and the power that that has given individuals with a business mind to find options and opportunities on a global scale. And if we continue, Mr. Speaker, to isolate ourselves by communities, we will serve ourselves a disservice. It's absolutely essential that all of us in this House, regardless of the political stripe we represent or the community that we represent, that we work collectively, to find governance models that provide a brighter future for our regions and collectively the province. Mr. Speaker, I'll conclude my comments with a reference that my colleague from Pictou West spoke to. And I want to speak about Pictou County, and I want to speak about the memorandum of understanding that four municipal units are advancing in that community. Mr. Speaker, in October of 2013, there was tremendous animosity between the UNSM and its membership and the provincial government. And Mr. Speaker, today that's not the case. The work that Pictou County has advanced, the relationship that four municipal units have created and have brought together in a formal memorandum of understanding is about pursuit of a regional government model. It is about the future of Pictou County, it is about the region of that piece of Nova Scotia, and it is to the betterment of all Nova Scotia. So I want to share my comments with my colleague from Pictou West, and I ask that she take my comments back to her community leaders to endorse their work, to continue that pursuit, and, Mr. Speaker, collectively, to find a model of government that serves the purpose of Pictou County and, by example, serves a purpose for all of Nova Scotia. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
The Honourable Minister of Municipal Affairs.
With that, Mr. Speaker, I rise to close debate on Bill 103, Municipal Government Act.
Motion is for second reading of Bill number 103, the Municipal Government Act. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary minded, nay. Motion is carried.
Bill number 103, entitled an act to amend Chapter 18 of the Acts of 1998, the Municipal Government Act.
Ordered that this bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. The Honourable Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, please call Bill number 102, the University Pension Plan Transfer Act.
We'll now call Bill number 102, the University Pension Plan Transfer Act. The Honourable Minister of Finance.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that Bill 102, entitled An Act to Facilitate the Transfer of University Pension Plans to the Public Service Superannuation Plan, now be read a second time. Last week, I had the privilege of introducing enabling legislation that will give Nova Scotian universities more options for becoming sustainable. This bill makes it possible for universities to transfer their pension plans to the Nova Scotia Public Service Superannuation Plan. It could play a major role in helping universities become more sustainable. Thanks to the University Pension Plan Transfer Act, universities could save millions of dollars and offer more security to their pension plan members. Yesterday, we mentioned that the members of the Acadia University Pension Plan and University Board of Governors have already agreed to move to the Public Service Superannuation Plan for their retirement plan. In fact, they voted overwhelmingly to do so. And starting in 2017, Acadia expects to save $3.6 million a year as a result of moving to the Public Service Superannuation Plan. Mr. Speaker, this change will bring more than 700 current and retired Acadia Pension Plan members into the provincial plan, which is 30,000 members strong. Acadia is the first university to join the provincial superannuation plan, but it need not be the only one. A healthy pension plan needs to grow its active members to promote long-term financial sustainability. Increasing plan membership creates an opportunity for risk sharing. This legislation gives the Nova Scotia Public Service Superannuation Plan the option to grow by adding university pension plans to their numbers. As you can see, Mr. Speaker, this is a win-win situation and win-win legislation. The University Pension Plan Transfer Act is enabling legislation. It does not create an agreement between universities and the provincial superannuation plan. That will happen through the transfer agreements between any interested university and the independent trustee of the provincial superannuation plan. The independent trustee will ensure that any university pension plan transfer will remain cost neutral or beneficial for the larger plan. This legislation simply creates the opportunity for these agreements to take place. And Mr. Speaker, I look forward to hearing from the critics and others in the House on this bill. Thank you.
The Honourable Member for Northside Westmount.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And it's a pleasure to rise to speak to Bill 102 here this evening about the transfer of university pension plans to the public superannuation plan. Mr. Speaker, we know a lot of people in this province have no pension plan whatsoever. To take a plan that's already in existence and transfer it over to the provincial taxpayer, Mr. Speaker, kind of defeats the whole purpose of trying to get universities accountable because, Mr. Speaker, they're funded by provincial taxpayers' money anyway. They're going to take one pension plan, transfer it to another pension plan that the taxpayer is going to fund again. It almost seems like, Mr. Speaker, they're trying to move money around to make it look like the universities are going to be sustainable, but it's still going to be on the backs of the taxpayers of the province of Nova Scotia. Mr. Speaker, the bill talks about transferring in whole or part the liabilities of the plan. And Mr. Speaker, if the assets were in place already in the plan they're already in, there'd be no need to transfer those assets into the superannuation plan of the province. Mr. Speaker, the question I have with this bill is, will the body from which the money, the plan is being transferred, make up the difference in the plan if it's already unfunded. Mr. Speaker, if it's an unfunded pension plan, there's a shortfall somewhere. So either the people going into the superannuation plan are going to be made topped up, funded by the province, by the university is leaving, or are they going to take a cut in their pension, Mr. Speaker, because of the unfunded liability they carry into the plan? That's one of the questions I have. You know, Mr. Speaker, if we transfer the risk of the university pension plans to the province, it's also a risk to the pension plan, to the taxpayers of Nova Scotia. If the funding is not met, Mr. Speaker, in their projections over the years, the taxpayer will have to make up the difference. So, Mr. Speaker, who will be investing in this pension plan? Sure, it will be the people that are already in the plan, but it will also be the taxpayer in the province of Nova Scotia. Mr. Speaker, we just heard from the minister say that in 2017, Acadia hopes to save $3.6 million. Mr. Speaker, they're going to save that because they're not paying into the Acadia pension plan. Who's going to make that payment? Mr. Speaker, putting 30,000 new members in the superannuation pension plan is great to have new members, but if that plan doesn't meet projections in the amount of money it's going to grow with, somebody's going to have to fund that pension plan, Mr. Speaker. And if it's part of the superannuation pension plan, it's going to be those members that are in it already or the taxpayers of the province of Nova Scotia. And we know growing a membership is great, but who's going to pay the unfunded portion? Mr. Speaker, allowing the universities to increase, to take a cap off their tuition this year and transferring the pension plan over is great. It looks good on paper. It makes the universities look like they're being sustainable, but the still cost is coming from the taxpayer of the province of Nova Scotia. It's still downloaded on the taxpayer of Nova Scotia. And Mr. Speaker, I look forward to the comments from the minister on this, but I also look forward to this going to law amendments to see where this goes, to see how it shakes down. Thank you very much.
The Honourable Leader of the New Democratic Party.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased to rise in my place to make a few remarks on Bill number 102, the University Pension Plan Transfer Act. Mr. Speaker, I want to start by saying that I think we all recognize the complexity of pension plans, and I certainly recognize the complexity of pension plans, and I don't pretend in any way, shape, or form to have a great deal of expertise in this area. It's a very complicated area, and one where there are many, many people who just dedicate their entire professional careers into the features of, you know, investment and managing pension plans. Pension plans, we know, in public sector organizations and in private sector organizations, have been under a lot of stress in the past, well, probably 15 years or more. But particularly, I think, in the last number of years where we have seen declining interest rates and the return on the rate of investments has left many, many plans struggling to remain solvent in some ways. And as my colleague from Cape Breton Westmount, Northside Westmount, just talked about the unfunded liabilities, and we have seen a number of the plans in the province have pretty significant unfunded liabilities, like the public sector pension plan for a long time had a substantial unfunded liability. The teacher's pension still has a significant unfunded liability. And we know that in the last number of years, the university pension plans have indeed had some challenges. I know that we have made some adjustments in this legislature to provisions for the Dalhousie pension plan, for example. Now, I'm not, and our caucus are not opposed to this legislation, but we're not at the point where we're going to support this legislation either. We have questions about this legislation. We have a lot of questions about this legislation. I know, for example, that the number of people who are members of the public superannuation plan has started to shift in terms of more people drawing on that plan than people coming into the plan, for example. I mean, I don't know it's that stark, but there are less and less people, and with a government that's downsizing the number of public servants, there will be less people contributing to a plan that has still a fairly substantial number of people drawing on that plan. And so the idea of building the base of that plan is perhaps a very valid idea. However, there are these questions about those plans that are brought into the public superannuation plan, which, by the way, is in very good shape today as a plan. It's in excellent shape. And so I think the concern would be that we want that plan to continue to be in very good shape. And if it ended up in a situation where it was in any way having to take on unfunded liabilities from new entrants into the plan, then that advantage that we have gotten will have been lost. The advantage of having put that plan on a stable footing will be eroded, and we'll be right back where we started from. And so I can understand why a university such as Acadia, for example, would see this as an excellent opportunity to stabilize their own plan and be part of a more secure public superannuation system, but I don't know what that means really for the future of the plan. And if you had, let's say, NASCAD coming into the plan, Cinevex coming into the plan, all of the unfunded liabilities with some of those plans could have repercussions on a very stable plan. So these are questions I have, and I know the minister is listening very carefully and will provide us with some answers and some assurance and some certainty that these things have been considered by the government. We just simply don't have enough information. And the final thing I would say, Mr. Speaker, on this bill is that the minister in her comments and in I think the release that went out talked about the savings that will accrue, for example, to Acadia if they join this plan, if this bill proceeds, are in the magnitude of more than $3 million annually. And so my question would be whether or not the government has considered asking the university to reinvest some of those savings in keeping tuitions at an affordable rate for students, rather than accruing these savings, and we're not really sure where they will be reinvested within the operation of our universities. So, you know, we have another piece of legislation that we'll be debating shortly with respect to the affordability and the sustainability of our university sector, and I look forward to discussing that, but I'm disappointed that we didn't hear about any of the reinvestment into making universities more affordable, particularly for students. If we're going to assume unfunded liability and risk into the public sector, into our public superannuation plan, then I think it is incumbent on us to ensure that there are benefits that accrue to probably the most vulnerable and disadvantaged in some ways among us, students who are bearing growing and growing debt loads, the cost of tuition spiraling beyond the ability of some students to get access to a university education, and then the pressures that are placed on our young people if they do get access, and the need to leave our beautiful province to find gainful employment someplace where they can actually have a wage that will help them pay off those large debt loads. So with those few words, I look forward to listening to any interveners that appear before us at the Law Amendments Committee on a bill that I think may look quite innocuous, but is anything but in terms of some larger issues and implications, Mr. Speaker.
If I'm to recognize the Honourable Minister of Finance, it will be to close second reading on Bill Number 102, the University Pension Plan Transfer Act. The Honourable Minister of Finance.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Speaker. I do rise to close debate on Bill 102, and I wanted to answer a few of the questions that were raised by the two members opposite in their discussion about this Bill 102. And I'm surprised that the member from Needham did not make a greater case about the good work that was done under her government to set the public service pension plan on a solid footing, because that was something that was done a number of years ago. The pension agency was created. The public service superannuation fund, if you remember at the time, a great deal of money was committed towards its liability, but it was left 100% funded. And there was an adjustment to pension indexing, so it isn't automatic unless it's 100%. It was really rolled out to be set on a solid footing. And here we are a few years later. I understand in the preparation for today, speaking to our staff, that they are around 100% funded today. So really the member opposite perhaps had not been thinking about that, but the former finance minister, Graham Steele, had done something that was pretty courageous and difficult. And at the time in opposition, we went for a briefing on what went on, because people were saying, oh, the pension plan's been bailed out and it's super expensive. But when we heard it, we said, this is in the long-term interest of Nova Scotia. And we've said that here in government, too. If you're doing something, you're doing the right thing, and it's in the long-term interest of Nova Scotia, it should be acknowledged. And we acknowledge it from previous governments. So that work of the previous government setting the plan on a strong footing meant, and this is very important to the member from Northside, I can't remember, Westmount, in Cape Breton, in North Sydney, very important that members of your caucus realize that the fund is well-funded, that in setting it up with that arm's-length pension agency, the government of Nova Scotia is no longer required to backstop that plan. That means if it gets underfunded, we are not on the hook. Taxpayers of Nova Scotia are not on the hook. So that we are out of that game. It absolutely, if the plan is not well managed, but our obligation, though I think it's important to note, is as the employer, we still have an obligation to match the contributions of our members, just like every employer in the province that has a pension plan. So we continue to do that, but we set up this agency with a solid footing, with 100% funding, with new rules, and I know there are still, and I appreciate it, there are some unhappy people that are pensioners because it isn't as guaranteed as it was before, but we've set it up, the previous government set it up to be solid, and it still is today, and this is why this move, that the bill that's before us, is about enabling legislation to let the people that run the pension plan, that would be our pension agency, Nova Scotia Pension Agency, and their trustee, because they have a board and they have a trustee, that person has a legal fiduciary duty to protect the members of the plan. That's how you choose somebody to be your trustee for a pension plan. They have to take on the responsibility to ensure that nothing is agreed to, nothing is done that will harm the plan. Now, they can't guarantee the returns in the market. They can't guarantee some of the risks that are out there, because every pension plan is subject to the low interest rates or the vagaries of the markets as you look at the capital markets. But they engage in the best possible financial management for the plan, get the best advisors, and invest the money to get the best return possible. That's their job. And they would never enter into any arrangement that is going to weaken the plan for existing members. So that's the whole premise of this bill, is that we're allowing the trustee to sit down and enter into an agreement, in this case with Acadia University, but in future it might be other universities, to say, is there an advantage to both of us to have these plans joined together? And in the Acadia instance, that's 700 members. That's a very small pension plan. That includes retirees and working members. It doesn't give it a lot of strength or a lot of depth when you only have 700 members in a plan. There's not a lot of people to go to when it's underfunded. It's not robust, if you like. If you join a plan that has 30,000 members, the risk is spread much more widely. Individually, the risk is much smaller. And there are some real savings for everybody involved, and I wanted to mention this too. So first, I want to be absolutely clear, though, to the member from Westmount and Westside, that there is no obligation for the taxpayers to bail out. That's an old situation. It goes back 4 years or more. I'm not sure which year Minister Steele did that, but it goes back some time. And what we're looking at today is a much stronger, independent plan where we are the employer. We will always make our payments and our obligations. But nobody's coming back to the taxpayers of Nova Scotia if the markets don't perform well or if they haven't been well invested. And the members of the plan and the pensioners as well sit on a committee together to follow and monitor and know what's going on, and they entrust a person who's called the trustee to look out for their interests. And that's really important. So what we have before us is enabling legislation, and it doesn't make the deal happen. It just sets the ground rules that says now that the trustee from the public service superannuation plan can sit down with the administrators of the Acadia plan and work out a transfer agreement that isn't going to negatively impact our plan, the public service plan. So they will be responsible for the nitty-gritty, the ins and outs. All the liabilities and the transfer of assets and liabilities will take place, but they'll have to ensure that it's being done in such a way that it doesn't impact the current members of our plan and is a benefit to the Acadia plan. And as I said, being a member of a plan that has only 700 members, it doesn't give you a lot of security, if you like, and their plan is not as well funded. Another part that makes it attractive for them to come and join the superannuation plan is that because they were a small plan, their administrative fees are higher. And I know there's a few people here who've worked in investments who understand that. If you have a small pool of money, you pay more to administer it or get it invested. If you have a much larger pool of billions of dollars, that allows you to get some real economies of scale. Now the Acadia pensioners, as they join into this plan, will have that advantage. The return on investment that they forecast is over 1% higher in the public service superannuation plan than it is in the Acadia plan. So that may not sound like a lot, but when you're talking about, you know, hundreds of millions and billions of dollars, getting one point higher or 1.5 points higher is really significant. I know that the Acadia plan is 5 point something. I don't have it exactly in front of me, but the plan that we operate is over 6%. So you're looking at a point higher that's worth really millions of dollars to the plan when Acadia comes to join. It's a benefit to them. Their projections will be a higher return on the money invested. And that's partly because it's going to be less administration fee, partly because it's a bigger, more, just a larger organization with a lot of resources to go back to. So I think that, you know, we have to look at this. I said in my opening remarks of a second reading, it's a win-win for, I think, for everybody. It's going to help the university be on a stronger footing because they will also see their huge liability, which so many organizations carry for pensions, they'll see that liability decrease because their pension plan will join in with the security and the size of the public service superannuation plan. So that's going to be a great savings and support to the university. For the members, they'll also see that they have, you know, more security, their plan will be better funded, they won't have that insecurity of wondering if there would be a time when the fund hasn't got enough resources, and the university doesn't have the money to pump in to bring it back to a good level of funding. So overall, we reduce the risk all the way around by going with this plan. And I think that risk sharing is a big part of it. The larger pool of members is a huge part of it. The Acadia members in that plan, the 700 active and retired members, agreed overwhelmingly. I believe it was almost 90% of the members that voted agreed to do this. They see it as beneficial. There will be some changes in their benefits or in the formulas. I gather that we were asked at the bill briefing, and I think some might be beneficial and maybe some not as much. But the union members, or the members of this plan, I shouldn't say their union, I don't know what their circumstance is, but the members of the pension plan know that they've had a chance to review it, and they've had a chance to vote on it, and they've said overwhelmingly, almost 90% said, yes, let's go that route because of the long-term sustainability and knowing that when they need to retire and when they need the benefits, they will be there because they will be entering a plan that is on a strong financial footing. And I'll say again, I'm really surprised that the member from the leader of the NDP did not take full credit for some very hard work that was done from her previous government. So again, this is enabling legislation. It does not leave the taxpayers exposed, and it will be good all the way around. We'll not be a party to that transfer agreement. The government of Nova Scotia doesn't get involved because it is an arm's-length agency. The pension agency, their trustee, will take care to guard against any harm to the existing members of the plan. And again, they have a certain benefit too, and I think the member from Needham touched on it, and that is having a larger pool of members. The bigger your pool of members, it's good for them. Even though they have 30,000, and that's a big plan in Nova Scotia, maybe our largest, it is not big by national terms or in terms of other places. So the more members they have, again, the better they can protect their members by having more active members paying in and being able to manage that. And I think that that's something they'll be looking at. Again, having more members to spread the risk a little bit more widely. And Mr. Speaker, I expect that this will be well received. It offers the opportunity to other universities, should they desire. There is no obligation. There is nothing heavy-handed here. It's simply enabling legislation to allow them to take advantage of something that is good for the pension plan and good for the pensioners that may choose, or the pension members that may choose to come over, and can be good for their institutions. Ultimately, we do have some obligation, and some commitments, I would say, with our higher education sector. So we benefit in that indirect way, but not in a direct way. So with that, Mr. Speaker, I move second reading of Bill 102.
Motion is for second reading of Bill 102, the University Pension Plan Transfer Act. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried.
Bill number 102, entitled An Act to Facilitate the Transfer of University Pension Plans to the Public Service Superannuation Plan.
Ordered that this bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. The Honourable Deputy Government House Leader.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, please call Bill number 100, Universities Accountability and Sustainability Act.
We'll now call Bill number 100, the Universities Accountability and Sustainability Act. The Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I move that Bill 100, an Act respecting accountability and sustainability of universities, be now read a second time. Mr. Speaker, since I tabled this bill last week, I've heard from many Nova Scotians who welcome the steps we're taking with respect to accountability and cost control at our universities. This is certainly in keeping with what we heard last fall during our consultations about the future of Nova Scotia's universities. Mr. Speaker, I've also heard from some parties who have concerns with certain aspects of this bill, and I want to take the opportunity to remind the members of this House why we brought this legislation forward. Mr. Speaker, the reality is this. Universities across the country are struggling to rein in costs and balance budgets while offering students high-quality education. If nothing is done, our universities here in Nova Scotia are facing an annual deficit of tens of millions of dollars in just 2 years' time. And universities struggling with serious budget shortfalls have had to come to government for help. That can't continue, Mr. Speaker. Bill 100 does two things. One, it requires universities to be more accountable. And two, it gives universities two potential processes to restructure themselves. Mr. Speaker, I think we can all agree that accountability shouldn't be left to chance, it should be law. The University Accountability and Sustainability Act requires more standard financial reporting and gives government a clearer picture of the university's books. It has teeth, Mr. Speaker, up to and including the authority to refuse or withhold grants in extreme circumstances. Universities will have to provide financial reports and updated financial forecasts every year. Under this part of the legislation, Mr. Speaker, universities would also have to set outcomes and measure progress in meeting them. These outcomes would be developed with the university and would align with both the university's priorities and provincial priorities. And of course, Mr. Speaker, they would also respect the university's autonomy and the principles of academic freedom. That's the first part of the legislation, Mr. Speaker, more accountability and cost control. I liken it to an early warning system that will help catch problems before they become emergencies. The second part of the legislation gives universities tools to restructure themselves. I look at it like an insurance policy, Mr. Speaker. Good to have, but something you hope you'll never have to use. And Mr. Speaker, if we approach this the right way, the accountability piece, the first piece of the legislation, should keep universities from ever having to use the revitalization process, that second part. We have to give them options to get back on the right track. A revitalization plan will help universities restructure financial and academic affairs and gives them clear process and the time to deal with serious financial issues and make changes to ensure they're here for the long term. Mr. Speaker, there are really two main scenarios where universities could use a revitalization plan. A university could proactively use this process if future trends point to financial trouble, like predictions of a significant loss of research funding or a drastic decline in enrollment. In this instance, Section 8, the section around the extension of collective bargaining, does not apply. The other scenario, Mr. Speaker, is more serious. In this case, we're talking about a university that's in real financial distress. In other words, it may not be able to keep operating or pay wages in the near term. Mr. Speaker, without this legislation, the only option a university would have currently would be to begin the receivership and ultimately the bankruptcy process. Mr. Speaker, imagine the impact that would have on students and the people employed by the university, its professors, its clerks, and its students. It would completely destroy the university. Bill 100 gives universities another solution. A facilitator and an advisory committee would work with the university to develop the plan and consult with stakeholders, including students, staff, faculty, and unions. Mr. Speaker, revitalization plans will consider a wide range of issues that can cut costs or raise revenue. Those issues could include research and learning goals, collaboration with other universities and partners, staffing, and the impact of the plan on all students. Mr. Speaker, if a university can show it's at risk of financial collapse and is in the midst of collective bargaining, it would have an option to extend negotiations beyond the end of the plan process. Mr. Speaker, this only happens if the university can demonstrate a significant operating deficiency. Independently verified financial documents would have to clearly show that a university couldn't continue to operate unless something was done. If granted, an extension would mean that the ability to strike or lockout would be suspended and a final collective agreement could not be signed until the planning process is complete. Madam Speaker, I want to be clear that negotiations can continue while the planning process is underway, and the option to strike or lockout or finalize an agreement is back on the table once the revitalization plan has been finalized. Mr. Speaker, an extension will allow everyone in the university community to focus on the plan's development to ensure the university is around and healthy for the long term. Mr. Speaker, let's be honest. If a university is fighting for financial survival, a strike or lockout could be the final nail in the coffin. Madam Speaker, the University Accountability and Sustainability Act is the first of its kind in Canada. It's about holding our institutions accountable and making sure our universities are here for years to come. Regular financial reporting and projections will give a clearer picture of a university's financial situation and help catch issues before they become emergencies. And revitalization plans offer a tool of last resort to help universities in significant financial trouble get back on track. Acadia President Ray Ivany summed it up perfectly, Mr. Speaker, and I quote, "When you have millions of dollars of public money being put into any activity, there's an onerous responsibility that goes with that. The earlier, quite frankly, that you can identify risk factors, the greater the number of options you have to deal with that. I see the university sector as one of the most important assets in the province and freely accept that it's our responsibility to get more out of the investment that the province has in the institutions for all kinds of economic, social, and cultural reasons." End quote. Mr. Speaker, it's hard to argue against legislation that will hold our universities accountable and make sure they're here for years to come. I believe in this bill and its intent to keep universities here for the long term. I expect that my colleagues across the floor may have some other views, and I look forward to hearing a range of views as it goes through the legislative process. Thank you.
Honourable Member for Northside Westmount.
Thank you, Madam Speaker, and it's a pleasure to rise to speak to Bill 100 this evening, the University's Accountability and Sustainability Act. Madam Speaker, let's not kid ourselves. Accountability for universities is a good thing. We've heard it from students, we've heard it from administration, we've heard it from residents, that more accountability is necessary when such large pockets of public money are being spent in this province. Madam Speaker, all the universities in this province need to get their house in order so they can provide a good quality education for our students. This will allow the universities to compete on a level playing field throughout the province. There will be no special deals for any university. It will be all in the open. Madam Speaker, the significant cost growth we have seen with our universities is a real concern. It is important that we also consider how the cost growth of universities is passed on to our students. When we're talking about taxpayer investment, more accountability is always a good thing. It is also good that expectations and processes will be clear for the universities. While this bill does provide more detail, before this legislation, it is still the responsibility of the minister to ensure accountability for students, or for universities, sorry. For example, in the old University Assistance Act, which this bill is replacing, the minister had the authority to prescribe the terms and conditions upon which a grant may be made. While universities are in trouble, the provision of collective bargaining may continue and be extended is a good thing. And Madam Speaker, my understanding is the only way that anything would happen where it's going to be suspended is when the university is in severe trouble. And I hope that that's the case, and I hope that that gets out to the people who are working in the universities and realize that while in severe trouble, this could possibly sink that university. It will provide added stability to the university as it determines its future during the revitalization process. This is what we must try to avoid. We must remember that university accountability is for taxpayers and for students. If the cost growth of universities is reined in, but students continue to pay for ever-rising tuition which they cannot afford, this becomes a real problem. When looking at the legislation, we must also not lose sight of the other actions of their government. We are still concerned about the elimination of the graduate retention rebate and the impact the removal of that support had on our students. We are also concerned about the one-time market adjustment we have students rising through in students' tuition. Despite this accountability legislation, the government has given universities a free pass to raise tuition by more than 3% if they feel so. They are moving ahead with this to fight the fact that our own consultations indicated Nova Scotians did not support this. We must also remain concerned that lifting the cap on tuition for graduate students will not be balanced out by the department's graduate research scholarships. We must also be mindful of our ability to attract out of province and international students, many of whom come to Nova Scotia and want to stay and work here. We must ensure that rising tuition does not impact our ability to attract these young people.
More accountability for universities and clear rules is a good thing. It is our hope that this legislation will help the cost growth of universities be curbed so that the savings can be found for taxpayers and students. Young Nova Scotians want and deserve affordable education which prepares them for good-paying jobs right here at home in Nova Scotia. Madam Speaker, let's see what has to be said in law amendments, and let's hope that as this passes through the process, we will hear from educators, we will hear from students, and we will hear from the universities to see what they think on this bill. Madam Speaker, I know accountability is a good thing, and we like to see that, and we hope that if universities become accountable, a university education for a young person or an older person in this province who wants to better themselves will be affordable for all. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
The Honourable Member for Halifax Needham.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair, Madam Speaker. I'm pleased to have an opportunity to rise in my place and speak on Bill 100, the University's Accountability and Sustainability Act. Madam Speaker, I'm not sure where to begin with respect to this act that's in front of us. You know, I thoroughly agree with the previous speaker. Accountability is extraordinarily important, and it's really extraordinarily important in all of our institutions that receive public funding. But this bill really very much isn't about accountability in terms of public funding. So let's be clear about that, and let's talk about the deficiencies in this bill. First, I want to say that I'm really very proud that I come out of the university sector in this province. Before I was elected to this chamber, I was a member of faculty at the School of Social Work at Dalhousie. You know, before that, I had the privilege of attending not only Dalhousie, but St. Evex. In Antigonish, and I have the greatest respect and admiration for the universities in the province and the university sector in many ways. This sector is very important to our province. It's a sector that employs literally thousands of Nova Scotians, not hundreds, thousands of Nova Scotians. I know that the faculty at Dalhousie alone are about 900, and for every faculty member, there are probably three non-faculty members, people who clean the buildings, maintain the buildings, people who are clerical and administrative support staff, people in the back offices doing payroll and paying bills and ordering materials, people in the libraries, people throughout those facilities that support that small core of faculty, which I was had the privilege of being among. So it's a sector that is very, very important in our province. And then on top of that are all of the students who are in our university, students who are from our province and students who are out from outside of our province and outside of our country. So we recognize that this is a very important sector. It makes an enormous contribution to the economy of the province, but at the same time, it is a sector that's expensive for the province. I think the minister has said at different times it's a $300 million investment, and it's no secret that as a small province, we have struggled to financially support our many universities. And the federal-provincial funding formula does not work to this province's advantage. I recognize all of those things. You'd have to be kind of out of it if you didn't recognize that that's the challenge. There have been many, many studies into the university sector in our province, and not a lot of creative solutions to how we deal with this challenge. And so we're left with this dilemma. And I don't envy the government. I don't envy the minister. It's a dilemma that has been faced by previous governments of two different political stripes. We have this asset that's very valuable and is a strength to the province and holds great potential for our prosperity, but it's also very expensive and at times unsustainable, and the whole question of affordability is there. Universities exist in a really competitive environment, nationally and internationally as well. And this adds a level of complication, Madam Speaker. This sector, and I know when people are choosing where to study in higher education, the factors are often the cost, the quality of the education, and the reputation and the culture of the environment you want to go study in. I look at my own life. I grew up in a family where nobody had been to university. And education was really important to my family. But when I was the oldest and when I started talking about going to university, my father said that it was too expensive. It would be too expensive. And I joke, many people have heard me joke about my dad's telling me that I would go to vocational school and take hairdressing. And that's the truth. I had a brother coming behind me, and my dad basically said, we will be able to maybe put one of the three children through university, and it will be the boy, because it wouldn't be wasted on a university education, wouldn't be wasted. My dad lived to regret those those words, which I reminded him of on a regular basis every time I graduated from a different university. It got to the point where he thought I would never have a real job. But, I think these are university education is a university education is something that many people ascribe to, but not necessarily are able to afford. And so the university sector is competitive. And when people look at, when they look at such a large investment, they look at where am I going to be able to afford to do this? Where is the program that's going to really meet my aspirations and help me become a gainfully employed person and somebody who can contribute to my community and my society? And what kind of, experience, life experience will it be? Now, the bill in front of us, unfortunately, does not do a thing with respect to the affordability and the cost of a university education. And perhaps it wasn't meant to do anything with respect to the cost of an education. We heard on the weekend, Madam Speaker, that the Cape Breton University is the first out of the gate with the increasing of tuition, with the raising of the cap, with the removal of the cap. And we're going to see a 20% increase in tuition in Cape Breton. And I can't help but wonder What kind of an impact is that going to have on the young people of Cape Breton? And also, in terms of its competitive position in this really competitive environment where cost is a factor. Does this bill do anything to help in that situation? It doesn't, you know. Quality. When I and other people, I think, chose the programs we went into, we wanted to go into a program that was recognized, that was of high quality, that we would be able to, as I said, make a contribution to our community and our province, find a good paying job, pay off our student loans, and what have you. This bill doesn't lay out any of the mechanisms that would hold a university accountable for the quality of the education that it's delivering. So it fails on that account. It fails on affordability and ensuring that cost is competitive and affordable. It fails on the question of quality, quality assurance, the employability of the students that are coming out of the programs. And I think the other thing that students look at, they look at reputation and culture. They look at, you know, is there a sports culture for people who are really interested in sports? And, you know, do the departments have hotshot researchers and publishers and thinkers? You know, is there somebody in that faculty who I recognize because they've been, you know, dynamic, like, you know, some of the people we see in our ocean sciences department here. I always think of Boris Worm, who is studying sharks and is quite inspirational. Sharks is not something I ever had much interest in until Professor Worm started talking about his research and his work on CBC Radio. So does this legislation deal with questions of reputation and culture? And sadly, we've seen the other side of reputation and culture. We've had now in Nova Scotia a couple of very damaging incidents of sexual misconduct, I guess I would say, in our universities where the kind of misogyny that was reflected in the chant in the orientation program at St. Mary's, and more recently all of the antics at the dental school, have really, I think, in many ways led to the real possibility that programs and universities in our region have had to deal with questions of their reputation. Those incidents become damaging for an institution where young people are looking for a program and they have a lot of choice, they have a lot of different places they can go, and any negative publicity about a program they might have been considering will result in their deciding, no, I'm not going there. Does this bill do anything to assure us that universities have in place the kinds of structures and policies and supports to make sure that sexual harassment and assault and misogyny is removed from those spaces? It's not in this bill. That would be That would be important, I would think, if you were going to bring forward a bill that would talk about the sustainability and the accountability of our institutions. So this bill has some really serious deficiencies in the bill. So as I said, Madam Chair, I totally agree with the idea that universities should be more accountable. And there needs to be more transparency. And it's a bit of a juggling act because at the same time they are autonomous. They are autonomous organizations, institutions of higher learning. You know, one of the things that a prior government did was introduce more accountability by making it required that people earning $150,000 or more, their salaries were posted. That made these institutions a little more accountable. And I think in that process, we discovered that at least one of the university presidents of one of the smaller universities was making almost as much as the president of the largest university. You know, and before that, that was unknown. In another case, we had a university president whose university was in serious financial trouble, who wasn't in the province, or the country, as a matter of fact, Madam Chair, for a considerable period of time during the height of a financial crisis. We've seen NASCAD, that we all love, a former president of NASCAD, go on an expansion and expending spree that jeopardized the future of that institution and left this province and no accountability for those decisions. So we have seen some pretty unaccountable behavior at the highest level of our universities that you could imagine. And this bill actually does not address those problems or how to make university presidents and their administrations more accountable. So how can this be a university accountability bill if it doesn't address those problems, if it doesn't give us the capacity to address those problems? A university administration that goes on a spending spree and builds all kinds of new capital buildings on a university campus that then they don't have the operating money to sustain. Sorry, Hansard. Or Ledge TV, rather. So, but there is accountability in this bill, but who is going to be held accountable for those problems? Well, I'll tell you, Madam Speaker, who's going to be held accountable. The electricians in the university system are going to be held accountable. And the teaching assistants, they're going to be held accountable. And the payroll clerks, they're going to be held accountable. And the instructors, they're going to be held accountable. And the part-time teachers who make obscenely low wages, they're going to be held accountable. And the faculty are going to be held accountable. That's who's going to be held accountable. In this bill. And how are they going to be held accountable? Well, their collective agreements are going to be suspended if a university gets into financial difficulty. They're not going to be allowed to collective bargain. They're not going to be allowed to go on a strike. They're not going to be able to do grievances. In exceptional circumstances, I heard the Minister of Finance say. So irresponsible management can go on a flight of fancy and leave a financial mess, and the staff, from the cleaners to the faculty, will bear the responsibility for that with Bill 100. Well, big surprise that this government has done that to the workers in our university system. This is what this government thinks of the workers in our healthcare system. It's what this government thinks about the workers in the film industry. And this now is what this government thinks about workers in our university sector. It's very, very concerning, very, very disappointing. This government had an opportunity to bring in a real piece of legislation to hold university administrators accountable. And they didn't do it. This bill is misnamed entirely. The other thing I want to draw members' attention to here, and I listened carefully to the minister when she made her remarks. You know, there's nothing new about workers in universities suspending collective bargaining during a crisis. NASCAD did it. The faculty union and the other unions at NASCAD did it. They didn't need a law to tell them that that was the right thing to do. They did it voluntarily. You know, all of the healthcare unions in this province, Nova Scotia Nurses Union, Nova Scotia Government Employees Union, CUPE, Unifor, Service, the Service International Union, Employees Union, they all suspended collective bargaining when H1N1 reared its head in the province, and they were actually at the table. Some of those unions were at the table. And then other unions in this province followed suit. The teachers' union, the instructors in the community colleges. And they did it because they recognized that there was a greater good than their own particular interests. And I want to remind members of this House that the members of these organizations are Nova Scotians, and they know how to put their province first, and they know how to put their institutions first when they're in financial trouble. It's been demonstrated, and they don't need any heavy-handed, ham-fisted law to make them do it. And that's what Bill 100 is. This is the fifth piece of anti-worker legislation that the McNeil government has brought forward in under 2 years. Bills 30, 37, Bill 1, can't remember what the other one was, but it was around the first contract legislation, and now this one. And it's so clear that this government learned absolutely nothing with the fiasco they made of Bill 1. This government has no difficulty eroding the rights of working people, the right to withdraw your labor as a means to get a fair collective agreement. But you know, I understand that in the healthcare sector, when you're dealing with life and death situations, and I know that very well, there is a difference. But in the university sector, to take this approach to the rights of people who work in this sector is breathtaking to me. How little this government values, respects the hard-won rights of working people in this province. The constitutional rights, the charter rights that the courts, our Supreme Court, over and over and over again upholds. Madam Speaker, there is nowhere in the country where legislation like this Bill 100 exists. Nowhere in the country. And I can assure members that people across the country are watching to see what happens on this bill. It gives me no comfort in knowing that our province is increasingly being looked on as kind of a backwater with respect to the rights of workers. And we have not been in this situation for a very, very long time, Madam Speaker. So we will be in the Law Amendments Committee, our members, listening with great interest to people who come forward to talk about Bill 1 and how they understand Bill 1 and the impact that they see Bill 1 having. But I'm afraid that this bill is a bill that requires serious, serious redrafting if the minister truly wants an accountable, sustainable university system. She's not going to get it, Madam Speaker, with what's here. And this sector deserves better than this. It deserves a lot better than this, and it needs good legislation to help it be more accountable and more sustainable. But that's got to start at the top. Accountability has to start at the top of these organizations. not at the bottom of these organizations. And that's where this bill fails entirely. Entirely. I don't know what kind of consultation happened. I've heard a bit about some of the consultations. I know the students weren't all that happy about the consultations that happened. They were very controlled. They were very confined to a set of predetermined questions that would lead you in a particular direction. But in the last number of days since Bill 100 has been introduced, I've had an opportunity to talk with faculty members and members of some of the other unionized groups who work in universities. And I can assure you, they did not see this coming. There was no consultation with them whatsoever that would give any indication that this government would go in this direction. And I think the disappointment and anger that people are feeling, that they are the ones that are being held accountable now for the decisions that are being made by a very small but a growing group of administration in the university sector, is of great, great concern to them. And as I indicated, this bill does nothing to contain costs. This bill does nothing to require that university administrators do the heavy lifting to make sure universities are affordable. And we know that the government has lifted the cap on tuition. This essentially gives carte blanche to the university administration to do what they want with tuition. And it will be the young people of our province and from outside who will bear the consequences, and then we will all bear the consequences of that. So, Madam Speaker, those are my thoughts on this bill. I'm sure we'll have more opportunity to speak on this bill as it works its way through the House of Assembly, and I look forward to hearing from presenters at the Law Amendments Committee. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
The Leader of the Opposition.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I am very pleased to rise and just say a few words about this bill. It's a very important one. Certainly, let me start on a positive, Madam Speaker. Efforts to drive more accountability in our system throughout government, in this case to our university sector, are of course good things, and we should all look for ways to increase accountability to the taxpayers who ultimately paid the bills, to the students who are there on the receiving end, in this case, of hopefully a quality education in our province, to Nova Scotians who want to benefit from an enriched economy, enriched cultural life, enriched educational life for the province as a whole. There are a number of stakeholders who count on the government to enforce accountability to them, Mr. Speaker, and I'm pleased to see a bill that furthers us down that road. Now, Mr. Speaker, is it a perfect bill? No, it isn't, for a variety of reasons, which I'm pleased to enumerate. I can see the minister wants to hear my enumerated list of reasons, and I will get into those, but I do want to start on a positive, that it is important to drive accountability into our system. Now, Mr. Speaker, once again, though, we're faced with a bill from the government which calculates the cost of things, but really doesn't understand the value of those very same things. I know this is a bit of a tangent, but we just went through several vigorous weeks of debate in this House about the film industry, where the government saw only the cost and none of the value, which in that case it was ultimately proven was multiple times the value to the cost, which is why the government had to make changes to their plans at the end of last week, Madam Speaker. By their own admission, they didn't study either the economic value or the tourism value or the cultural value of the film industry to our province, or what it adds to our immigration goals or our demographic goals, like encouraging young people, or our export goals or our foreign direct investment goals. Mr. Speaker, that's a great example. And so here we have a bill that foresees the financial side of the university sector and drives accountability there, but again, does not allow for or contemplate any work into the value that our university sector brings to the province, either economically or culturally or otherwise. And that is a shame, because Nova Scotians, whether they're taxpayers or users of our university system, they want to know that they're getting value for dollars received. And that ought to be part of the decisions that get made when you're driving accountability through the system, Mr. Speaker. But of course, part of that value add comes from whether our university system is affordable to the young Nova Scotians and others from around the world that want to access it, Mr. Speaker. And part of making it affordable is to make sure there's a great accountability for our dollars. And I guess that's where I come down on the accountability side. We're hopefully ensuring, through increased accountability, that the system remains affordable to Nova Scotia students. And I will return to that theme in a minute. But my point, Madam Speaker, is that yes, of course, who would be against increased accountability? Nobody. It's a general good, and we do need more of it. The question before us is whether this bill actually has real accountability or just is designed to give the perception of accountability, Madam Speaker, because generally speaking, the bill is broken into two big parts. One is accountability, and the other is the revitalization plan. The accountability section of the bill is the smallest part of the overall bill. And when you look at the provisions that it has for harmonizing financial reporting and defining expectations for funding, you got to ask, do you really need a bill to do those things? Aren't those things happening now? Isn't the Department of Labor and Advanced Education getting harmonized reporting? Aren't they looking for universities to give them information that they can use to oversee the system? And if they aren't, do they need an act of the legislature to ask for things that common sense tells us should be part of everyday life? So I'm not arguing against the bill. I'm just saying I wonder if it really needs a bill in the legislature to ask the universities to report in a standardized way. Not even to ask, since we're a funder of over $300 million to our universities, to require it without needing to make it the law. You know, Madam Speaker, I remember 10 or 11 years ago, the first memorandum of understanding with the universities was designed and was signed off on, and it required some administrative savings from the universities in return for 3 years of funding so they could make investment decisions beyond 1 year. It had real provisions for reporting on how that savings was achieved to the government. And if the minister looks, she'll see that the CFOs or the VP finances of the universities actually got together and they built a common chart of accounts that all the universities could report on. No act of the legislature was required to make that happen. It happened through good, strong oversight from the government, Madam Speaker. And I would like to see good, strong oversight from this government of our university sector. I just want to make sure that the bill isn't just a way of appearing to be doing something instead of actually doing something that the department has every right to ask for already, and that is for standard financial reporting to the department, for a common chart of accounts, as we talked about a moment ago, asking universities to do certain things in exchange for the funding that they get. I suspect the minister will get up and give me all the reasons why it absolutely has to be an act of the legislature, but I hope one of them isn't to look like we're doing something, because it's time that these things actually happened in practice, Madam Speaker. Now, I mentioned a moment ago that, of course, driving increased accountability should lead to greater affordability for young Nova Scotians to use our system. And of course, it is one of the ways that that can happen. But, Madam Speaker, it's important to put this one bill in the context of all of the government's actions to date when it comes to our university system. You know, I saw a young man on the news last night, Brandon Ellis, from Cape Breton University. I think he's their student union president. And he very quickly pointed out that their tuition, which has been allowed to rise beyond the traditional 3% cap, is going to price a lot of his friends and a lot of young Nova Scotians who want to strive to go as high as they can in life out of the university market. Or if they choose to go elsewhere to attend university in another province, in Newfoundland or in New Brunswick or in Ontario, wherever they choose to go, Madam Speaker. And a 20% increase in tuition at CBU will no doubt have that effect, because universities, it's a very competitive industry, Madam Speaker, where students, young Nova Scotians, have choices in the hundreds. And we're supposed to be in the business of attracting young people to our province and keeping young people in the province and hopefully not graduating them with a mountain of debt that will take them the first two decades of their working life to dig out of. So hopefully driving this extra accountability will generate some savings, but that savings is long lost to the student in the increased tuitions that they will pay. And I know one of my colleagues here on this side already pointed out that with the loss of the graduate retention rebate, young Nova Scotia students studying in our universities and graduating have, in fact, in the last year, faced the highest tax increase our province has ever levied on anyone in 1 year. And I know now we're almost to the end of April, and young graduates working here in the province will be filling out their first tax return, if they haven't already, and sending it off, and they are feeling the effects right now of the loss of that rebate in the thousands of dollars per person. The very people that the Ivany Report told us we have to encourage more of. So, Madam Speaker, on the one hand, it is fine. In fact, it's a good thing to drive greater accountability into our universities. But we can't expect that to be the end of the story, particularly if we have questions about whether there's real accountability or just pretend accountability. And at the other hand, overwhelm any savings that might result with higher tuition and lower support for indebted graduates. Madam Speaker, and I think Brandon Ellis did a very good job at describing that on the news last night on behalf of the students of Cape Breton University. And I'm sure we'll hear from other students. And I'm sure we'll hear from a lot of people involved in the university sector over the next few days. And Madam Speaker, that does bring me to the second part of the bill, which is the revitalization plan. And even here, Madam Speaker, I think this House should take some time and really look at what this does. Because on the one hand, I suspect that those that work in the university sector will feel that it's good to know what the rules of the game are if they get into trouble, as this part of the bill envisions. If they get into enough financial trouble that they really need to put up their hand and identify the need for a restructuring, that it's good to know what the rules of the game are. But, Madam Speaker, once again, you've got to wonder if this would ever really happen. Because if a university got to this point where they needed to trigger a revitalization plan, I hope they would realize, as I'm sure they would actually, the great risk they're running to their own feasibility. First and foremost, in enrollment for the following year, as it becomes plain to everybody in a very public way that that university's very existence is now in question. And even for alumni and donors and others that give of their time and money to make our universities sustainable, the risk that that would erode very quickly is very real. Madam Speaker, and I hope the government has thought of this. I hope the department has a plan to deal with this, because it would be a gigantic step for a university to enter into a revitalization plan, as this bill envisions, with all that goes into that, without knowing whether they'll basically scare away the next generation of students, the next year's enrolling students. and the donors and alumni that also will be paying attention to these things. So in a way, Madam Speaker, once again we ask, is this a real plan or is it a paper plan that will actually never get used? And you know, I find it very interesting, Madam Speaker, that the bill very specifically says that it is up to the university to trigger it. In other words, hands off on good, strong financial management of our university sector by this government itself. That they do not empower themselves in law to actually ensure to their own satisfaction that the universities are sustainable or that they're being managed in an affordable and accountable way. This can only happen if a university has driven itself into the ground and then chooses to trigger the revitalization plan on its own. What kind of government, wanting to show leadership, would actually stand by and watch all this happen, Madam Speaker, and have nothing to say about it, or not even empower itself to deal with it? And I absolutely get, Madam Speaker, that there is the need to respect academic freedom, to allow universities to run their own affairs. And that is something that I'm sure every member takes very seriously in this House, and it should be respected. But if you're going to drive accountability into the system, if you're going to ask for common financial reports, for the ability to change the university grants based on what the government wants the university to be doing, Madam Speaker, to then say, but if you get into serious trouble, oh, well, that's up to you. Well, I'm not sure that really is accountable, Madam Speaker. In fact, the only person, bizarrely, who exempts themselves from accountability in the situation of a serious problem at our universities is the Minister of Labor and Advanced Education, who denies the opportunity to give herself a chance to trigger a review of our universities. Now, Madam Speaker, we've seen this before in previous acts by this government, where the problems are always somebody else's to deal with. And if you have to hold the minister accountable or the government accountable, you're told, well, no, that's up to somebody else. If the small school in your area is under review, well, that's got nothing to do with the government. You have to go to the school board. That's for them, Madam Speaker. Now, if a university is in financial trouble, well, that's got nothing to do with the government. You have to go to that university and speak to them, Madam Speaker. If they raise their tuition by 20%, well, that's got nothing to do with the government. You have to go to the university. Well, Madam Speaker, accountability has to be at all levels, and that includes the minister, and it includes the premier, it includes the government. But they've exempted themselves in this bill from part of the accountability chain. Madam Speaker, that seems to me to be worthy of some further examination here, because we want the government to hold itself to the same level of accountability that it's holding our universities to in this case. Now, Madam Speaker, I don't know if the minister will agree with this analogy that I'm about to use or not, but as I read through the revitalization plan, it occurred to me that it appeared to be modeled on similar plans in the private sector, like the Companies Creditors Arrangements Act, commonly known as the Bankruptcy Act, which gives a company that has become insolvent the opportunity to restructure its affairs and find a sustainable way forward. So the minister can certainly tell us when she wraps up whether it's a fair analogy or not, but the concept is certainly the same, that when a private company reaches a point where it can't pay its bills, basically, it's given an opportunity to restructure. And in fact, someone is appointed to oversee it, and it restructures its affairs, including dealing with all of its creditors. And Mr. Speaker, or Madam Speaker, I'm sorry, Madam Speaker, I don't know why I'm doing that. Madam Speaker, this bill certainly contains some pretty rough provisions regarding labor relations, collective agreements that are in place, and the ability of both the employer to lock out or the union to strike deals with those. But it has none of the provisions that the private sector would have to actually reach an agreement with creditors of the university. The bill is silent on whether the university can turn to private sources that have financed their expansions, their parking garages, and their residences and dormitories and so on for those that have them, Madam Speaker. Many universities use capital funding for their expansions and borrow money, and there's nothing in the bill to say that maybe if someone has lent one of our universities more than they should have, that they ought to participate in the restructuring. Only the workers are asked in this case, Madam Speaker, to give a little in a restructuring of university, and it's kind of an odd choice for the government to make. I will say, Madam Speaker, when it comes to the union labor relations parts of the bill, that we really have lost any confidence in the government's ability to legislate in this area. They've already been turned away at least once, if not twice, by bringing bills before this House that could not withstand a legal challenge. And whether this one or not, it will be up to lawyers to say, but I really am disappointed the government bring another bill in that legislates in this area with no support for whether it's valid or not. Now, maybe they'll bring another arbitrator that will make rulings in this area, but you know, we've been down that road before and they made a complete mess of it. So I guess what I'm trying to say to the government is you're gonna have to provide a little more information than you have about whether this is a valid way of proceeding under the revitalization plan as it relates to the unionized provisions in the bill, Madam Speaker. Now, should there be a way for our universities to go down the road of restructuring their affairs if any of them got into the financial difficulty that the bill envisions? Well, yes, there should. And a good thing is at least there's a path forward, Madam Speaker. At least there's a path forward. And the revitalization plan does call for studies of the costs of a university and the ability to transfer assets to other entities and so on, but no talk about the value that organization brings to its community or to our province. And surely, if a university ever got to the point where it triggered a revitalization plan, someone in charge would want to know the value that institution brings to our province as well as the cost, Madam Speaker. But that's not in the bill. So I will just sort of summarize by saying that we generally agree with the approach of looking for greater accountability. We continue to have questions about whether this is real new accountability or whether it's just a bill to say what can already be done, which would be a shame, Madam Speaker. We look at the revitalization plan and have questions about whether it would ever get triggered, knowing the devastating effect on enrollment in the future and on donations in the future that triggering that plan would have. And I'd be interested to hear if the government actually has thought of those things or has a plan for those things, because if not, we have a hard time seeing where this would ever get triggered, Madam Speaker. And of course, we're all going to watch closely at law amendments in the next little while, and again when the bill comes back, to see that those questions get answered before the bill gets to a final vote. So with those few remarks, Madam Speaker, thank you very much for your time.
The Honourable Member for Sackville-Cobequid.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I'm glad to rise and say a few words on Bill 100, and I want to associate myself with the comments that my leader had presented in her debate on Bill 100. And I'm not going to rehash and go over all the points she made, but I have to say she made a strong argument to what the concerns are towards Bill 100. And I listened intently to the minister's comments on second reading, and one that stood out to me was her comment of the fact that it would be hard to argue against this legislation. And I guess I would agree with the minister if you don't believe in the rights and protecting the rights of Nova Scotians, especially Nova Scotian workers here in our province, Mr. Speaker, Madam Speaker. Sorry about that. And I say that, and I think we've been saying it on a number of pieces of legislation that this government has brought in over the last 16, 18 months. I try to figure out and I try to understand what the mindset of the government is when it comes to dealing with legislation that deals with workers and workers' rights here in Nova Scotia. And I don't know if it's the fact that they have a majority, if the government has a majority, Madam Speaker, that they feel they can bring legislation in, it'll pass, it'll become law, and that's just how it's going to be. But that's not how it is here in Nova Scotia, and that's not how it is here in our country, Madam Speaker. We've seen with previous bills, like Bill 1, it was a direct attack on the rights of health care workers, and Bill 100, it was hidden within the initial announcement, Madam Speaker. It is a direct attack on the rights of workers, especially workers, of course, who work within and who support our university system. As was said, there are thousands of Nova Scotians, thousands of them, who contribute to the university system that I believe all of us are here are very proud in, saying that our province plays an amazing and important role in educating not only our young people here in Nova Scotia, but people from around the globe. They come to Nova Scotia to educate themselves, Madam Speaker, and they are able to do that because of those thousands of workers who are there, who are faculty members, who are part-time instructors, who are people who are maintenance workers, who keep the universities running and able to run and provide those opportunities for Nova Scotians and from many from outside our province and our country. And the fact that the government believes they can just bring in legislation that erases rights that have been fought for so many years, for generations, Madam Speaker, and I find myself repeating myself from a previous piece of legislation. Workers in our province and across the country have worked extremely hard for decades to get rights. And it's not just something that the province can wipe out with a piece of legislation like Bill 100. And I thought the government would have learned their lesson with previous legislation. We have, here in our country, the Charter of Rights and Freedoms that really is the basis of what jurisdictions across the provinces and territories have to follow. And there had been a recent decision, a 5-2 decision from the Supreme Court of Canada that recognizes that the right to strike is a fundamental part of the collective bargaining process. The provisions in the Charter of Rights and Freedoms protect the right to strike. Maybe I should table the decision, but I won't. But there had been jurisdictions like Saskatchewan, Madam Speaker, who thought they had the ultimate right to just bring in legislation that wipes out rights and the protections that are in place that fall under the Charter. And we know the outcome. I believe it was January 30th of this year when that decision came out from the Supreme Court, Madam Speaker. And in the text of that court decision, it recognized the right to strike. And actually in the decision, it indicated it reduces strike frequencies by making collective bargaining meaningful. The court also noted Canada's international human rights obligations as a signatory to the international agreements protecting the right to strike under the international law. So it's not only our own country that recognizes the rights of workers, it's globally. And the question that we have, and it's not just our caucus, it's many in the labor movement, but it's faculty, staff, and those in labor are questioning again, does the government have the authority to bring in legislation that would wipe out those rights? I would say they don't. And I know I asked the minister that question in estimates, and I was told that they had done some consultation. It was with lawyers, and they feel confident that it would meet that challenge. And I guess if this proceeds and Bill 100 is passed in this legislature, then I guess we'll see down the road if it holds up, because I have no doubt in my mind that those Nova Scotians who are going to be impacted by this will ask for a decision, Madam Speaker. It's interesting, today we were met by people outside, and the government were met by people outside who were against Bill 100. And for those who might not know, there was another protest in Cape Breton along the Sydney Glace Bay Highway, I believe it's called, in front of CBU. Over 300 people were out today protesting against Bill 100. They were unable to get up to Halifax today, but they wanted to make sure that government knew that there are many people concerned with the second section of this piece of legislation, Bill 100. The first section, the accountability provision, I think everybody would agree that when an organization, no matter what it is, receives tens, hundreds of millions of dollars of taxpayers' money, there should be a level of accountability. Understood, I think everybody would agree with that. But in this piece of legislation, it's interesting to see that if a university finds themselves in dire straits or has severe financial problems, they're going to be given even more power, which baffles us, that they can take all these rights away from the workers. And as my leader indicated, I have great faith in the workers of this province, especially in our university system, that they would be more than willing to work with the administration of that university to get things back on track. They know what's at stake. They know the future of that university might be at stake, which means the future of their employment is at stake. I don't believe for one moment that we would see any of the bargaining units throughout the province who would be in that situation say, no, we're gonna continue down a path, and we're gonna be collectively bargaining to get more benefits and raise our wages. I don't believe that would happen. I have much more faith in our workers in this province, especially those who work within the university system. They're dedicated individuals, and they're not one that we hear often from, Madam Speaker. I've been in this legislature for almost 12 years, and I don't recall really having faculty and those associated with universities coming to the legislature, starting to kind of bring more awareness around letter writing and on social media. It just doesn't happen, because I don't think we've seen, and I know we haven't seen, legislation like this. The minister indicated, the government indicated, this will be the first of its kind in the country. That should give you an idea that maybe we shouldn't be the first in the country to bring such draconian results of attack on workers, especially after a recent Supreme Court decision. I mean, this will end up costing the government money when they have to defend this piece of legislation. And we've seen it in other pieces of legislation. Bill 1, and they came back in the start of this session to have a do-over. And the money spent through the arbitration process, I don't think the government has a tally on it yet, but it was hundreds of thousands of dollars to get to a point where the government could have reached at the start of it, Madam Speaker, if they would have just sat down and fully negotiated with the unions and to achieve what the government wanted to achieve. And I think the same thing could happen here. Why doesn't the government say, okay, we understand that there's big concerns here with the workers who are working within the university system, but one group I forgot to say that are also lending their voice to opposition to this bill are the students. And they're also concerned that they will be left out of any kind of consultation or talks if the revitalization plan or program is put in place, because it gives all that power. What this does, it takes power away from, I think, a productive mechanism to address serious issues, and it takes that power and gives it to the administration of the university, which they may be the reason why that university is in financial difficulties. That's what just is baffling to me and to our caucus, is that so they're going to give them more power and power to take away rights. The reason we have the Trade Union Act and the Charter and legislation nationally to protect workers, it was to make sure that they're part of being protected when an industry, for example, closes down. There has been examples time and time again where those workers their rights were not protected, and that's why we have decisions out of the Supreme Court of Canada that says workers' rights need to be upheld, they need to be protected, and jurisdictions, meaning provinces, territories, cannot just make up legislation that take those away. And that's exactly what Bill 100 does. So I foresee, as we go through this process, we're going to hear from more Nova Scotians. And the government's going to try to paint this as, oh, well, it's just unionized people. It's just the unions want to keep their rights. What Nova Scotians need to be reminded of is that these unions that are trying to protect the rights of unionized workers, these are Nova Scotians, these are workers. They live in communities all across our province. And they deserve the respect, I believe, that they've shown over the years when it comes to bargaining and trying to ensure that the viability of our universities continue on. Yes, through the last number of decades, there's been a few labor disruptions. I would agree to that. But by no means do I think it's at a point where government needs to introduce legislation to rip those rights away, to take them away, to not even allow grievances to happen. So something happens in a university and they're going to suspend the grieving process, and the minister can stand up when she wraps it up and try to explain that that's not going to happen. Workers' rights are all there. Well, that's just not true. This is a deliberate attempt to erode the rights of workers, Madam Speaker. It's something we've seen from this government time and time again. First it was healthcare workers, now it's going to be university workers. And it's just baffling to see that is happening here in our province. Students and workers really are the whistleblowers, Madam Speaker, when they see administration malpractice at our universities. They're the first ones that will sound an alarm if they see something not going right. As a caucus, we've all been in all different positions in this House. Who do we hear from? We hear from the student groups when they see administration of universities doing something that they don't think is right, and they make sure that we know about it. And I think through this legislation, it really muzzles those students. It muzzles the workers themselves. They can't even put a grievance in. If they are on strike, that'll have to stop. What's not missing in this legislation is the fines against those workers and the unions. I believe the unions could be fined up to $100,000, $10,000 a day if the university decides they're going to implement the revitalization plan, and if they are unfortunately on a strike, if they don't live up to this legislation, they could be fined $10,000 a day. Instead, what we'd like to see is a piece of legislation that goes after what the problem is. If it's the administration, then that's what the government should be going after. They should be taking rights away from the administration. The government should be scaling back their ability to cause damage to that university. And I'm not saying our universities are going to be going down that road. But we have seen some examples in the past that, you know, are concerning. That there was, I think, what was described in one of the news releases as a malpractice, administrative malpractice. After this legislation is passed, that university could have more power to cause more harm to that university, and it'll be at the detriment of not only the students but the workers that work there. So as we see this Bill 100 go through, I don't agree with the minister saying it's going to be hard to argue against this piece of legislation. I find it's going to be hard to agree to this piece of legislation, and unless there's changes to it, Madam Speaker, we know we won't be supporting Bill 100. Thank you.
If I am to recognize the Honourable Minister, it will be to close debate on Bill number 100, the Honourable Minister of Labour and Advanced Education.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I want to thank my colleagues on the opposite side of the House for their very thoughtful comments. I was here taking them down, and I hope I'm going to accurately reflect what was said back, just in answering a few of the issues raised. I'm not exactly sure how or why a minister would legislate when or how often a president of a university could leave the country, but I don't think I want to get into that level of management, and I would point out that at certain points when you become too prescriptive about what an institution does, that institution's bottom line becomes part of your bottom line. So there is an issue around that, about how far we can go. But what I would say is when I became minister and began getting briefings on the university situation here, it was clear to me there were certain things happening. I remembered back in 2009 when I was first elected and I began as education critic. And I would go visit university presidents and they would talk to me, and a number of them told me that they felt their institution had been seriously disadvantaged by the MOU of 2008. So some of them felt that they felt themselves sliding into some financial trouble in 2008 with that particular MOU. Fast forward to the previous government, which cut $35 million in funding from the universities. So some of the universities were coping with that 2008 situation, and then they had the rug pulled out from underneath them. So this is not to say that I am excusing financial mismanagement or anything like that, but I do want to put all of this in context so that people understand that there was no consultation. The NDP just cut $35 million from our university system over a period of years. I understand they had fiscal challenges to deal with, but that was the decision they took. Our decision has been a little different. Instead of cutting further in the university system, we have given them small increases. We have given them what taxpayers can bear, Madam Speaker. And yes, we are expecting our universities to be accountable, but the result of a number of decisions made by three separate administrations means that universities are challenged right now. So I just want to put that in context, because I know that some folks are worried about tuition increases, as am I. But I do want them to understand that all three parties have made decisions that have impacted our universities. When I first became minister, when I began having my briefings about universities, when I looked back in terms of a historical context, and I looked at when the two known cases, NASCAD and Acadia, when they got into trouble, there was no way that apparently, the government knew what was going on at those universities. I have to believe that whatever the process was at the time, because there's no way they would have let them slide into that kind of financial morass and make the deals that they did. So For me, the first thing I wanted to see was an early warning system so that we knew what was going on with universities. And quite frankly, that's how we get accountability. The Act states quite clearly, Madam Speaker, that the minister may, and you go down to designate by regulation institutions, B, specify the amounts of grants or any grant, C, specify the terms and conditions upon which the grant is made, including terms or conditions that must be satisfied before all or part of a grant is paid, and then it goes on to provide a number of accountabilities that the university may be required to provide, including evidence satisfactory to the minister of the sustainability of the university's financial operations, submit financial documents, etc., etc., etc. Enter in and comply with an outcomes agreement and apply the grant to a specified purpose. Madam Speaker, we have had successive governments sending money to universities for nursing that wasn't used on nursing. So I'm sorry, but the fact that that previous administrations just handed over money and said you should use this for nursing and never checked up to make sure that it was actually happening, I'm sorry. That was not accountability. There are things in place that should have provided accountability. Things like MOUs. I have bilaterals with every single university here that lasted for 18 months, Mr. Speaker, now we've switched, Mr. Speaker, and those bilateral agreements lay out goals for those universities and things we'd like to see them do, and they're mutually agreed upon, Mr. Speaker. So those actually exist. One of the members raised the issue, and what I do want to say is, you know, the first time one of our universities got in trouble because they didn't make sound financial decisions, I can understand it happening once, but it happened again. And my concern was there was nothing there that would prevent it from happening yet again. And that's why we needed to have this accountability piece. One of the members raised the issue of grievances and said that grievances could not be dealt with if a sustainability plan had been triggered or a revitalization plan had been triggered. That's not accurate. In fact, what it is that those grievances that are not related to the revitalization process could still proceed. I want to be very clear on that. And let me see, what else was there? And the members are right. We give our universities $376 million. It is only right and proper that there be some accountability for that funding. I think the university presidents understand why we would want to have that. And I'm really looking forward to hear what we're going to hear at law amendments throughout the next coming days. And from my honourable colleagues, I really do appreciate their thoughtful comments on the bill. And I look forward to proceeding. With this, I now move that we close second reading of Bill 100. Thank you.
Motion is to close. It's for a second reading of Bill 100, the University's Accountability and Sustainability Act. Would all those in favour of the motion please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded nay. Motion is carried.
Bill number 100, entitled an Act Respecting Accountability and Sustainability of Universities.
Ordered that this bill be referred to the Committee on Law Amendments. The Honourable Government House Leader.
Speaker, that concludes the government's business for this evening. Tomorrow we will meet on April 28, Tuesday, from the hours of 1 p.m. until 7 p.m., at which time, following daily routine, we will do consideration of third reading of bills number 82, 87, 88, and 90. We'll also do second reading of bills introduced today, 108, the Financial Measures Act, and 109, the Tourism Nova Scotia Act. With that, Mr. Speaker, I move that the House do now rise to meet again tomorrow, Tuesday, April 28, from the hours of 1 p.m. until 7 p.m.
Motion is for the House to rise until tomorrow between the hours of 1 p.m. and 7 p.m. Would all those in favor of the adjournment please say aye.
Aye.
Contrary-minded, nay. Motion is carried. The House now stands adjourned until tomorrow, April 28th at 1 p.m.